Casey and Footscray have just one Premiership Cup between them from a combined 32 VFL seasons since the league realignment in 2000.
To win the preliminary final for Werribee. It's a goal! And Springvale's fairy tale has ended.
The experienced players coming in.
You've got a feel for Springvale.
So, when an opportunity comes to add to the trophy cabinet, it truly is a moment to be seized.
Springvale is the 1998 VFL Premier.
Excuse me, people. If I've told you once, I've told you a thousand times. Never, ever, ever ride up the Scorpions!
The Casey Scorpions have been the pace setters all season long. Is today the day they finally put 15 years of September disappointments to rest? The Dogs have timed their run to perfection. 8 wins from their last 10 starts has seen them steal the double chance and rocket in the Premiership calculations.
Hits Garwood and gets it!
But now they must stare down the team that whipped them in the qualifying final just 3 weeks ago. Can they continue to ride the tidal wave of energy and belief that swept the Witten Oval this September? The opportunity has arrived for Casey and Footscray. Who will seize the ultimate prize? It's the 2016 VFL Grand Final, live from Etihad Stadium on Seven's VFL Match of the Day. All roads lead to Etihad Stadium this afternoon as season 2016 of the Victorian Football League reaches its climax. The Casey Scorpions facing Footscray for the VFL Premiership. The Scorps back at the big dance for the first time since 1999, while the Doggies, they're hunting their second VFL flag in 3 years and looking to ride the wave of momentum and emotion that swept over the kennel throughout September. Welcome everybody to Etihad Stadium. Great to have you with us. Jason Bennett alongside former Casey champion Nigel Carmody and Hawthorn's 2008 Premiership player Campbell Brown. Gentlemen, welcome. What a month it's been for the Doggies. Does that matter? Does that matter today, Brownie?
It certainly does. They're just riding a wave of emotion and it's got to rub off on everyone at the footy club. They're coming here full of confidence and why shouldn't they?
From a Casey perspective, they go in today as warm favourites. We've talked about their September disappointments in recent weeks. They're now up against a side that's so up and about. What difference does it make to the Scorps?
I think very little, and there's different DNA about this Casey team at the moment. The Melbourne-Casey alignment has never been better. So I think all those finals commiserations are pushed to one side today. They line up with 16 Melbourne players in their team, a quality Casey list. They're here to win it.
Incredible night last night at Spotless Stadium in Sydney. And Brownie, you said off camera a little bit earlier to me, this is one of the best games of footy you have ever seen.
The best game I've ever seen. I reckon this passage of play sums it up. They willed the ball forward. Clay Smith won a crucial 50-50 contest. And then Caleb Daniels sweeps on and kicks a really big goal for him.
It was an incredible game. There's Rob Murphy swept up in all the emotion after the game with Mitch Wallace. There he is with Marcus Bontempelli and Peter Gordon. So many great stories. The Dogs into their first AFL Grand Final in 55 years. More than 20,000 days. And as we said, the wave of emotion and momentum and belief and all those caravans of buses and cars have been driving home from Sydney today, and I'm sure we'll see plenty of Doggies fans here at Etihad this afternoon.
And made all the more meritorious when you think they're missing Bob Murphy, Lynn Jong's injured, Jack Redpath did his ACL during the year, Mitch Wallace a broken leg as well. So they've done it with some really significant speed bumps in the road.
It's been a very exciting month, and now the Dogs, after all these years of watching on from the sidelines, have 2 grand finals in 6 days, and it all starts for them this afternoon with the VFL Grand Final. Let's check their road to the finals for the Bulldogs. They didn't start all that well. They lost 3 of their first 4 games. Then they found a bit of rhythm. They won 3 straight. Their season through the middle of the year kind of went up and down on the spot for 5 or 6 weeks. However, they got hot at the right time, Brownie. They won 6 of their last 7 home and away games. They snatched the double chance in the final round, which they then cashed in the first week of the finals. They looked to be in trouble, 3 goals down to to Essendon at the last change in the semi, came back and won that, then annihilated Collingwood last week.
Yeah, 119 points. We didn't see that coming. They've just been simply superb and finding form at the right time.
KC won 7 of their first 8. Poor performance against Collingwood in round 10. Won a couple more. Dropped a game to the Dogs by a point in round 15. But since then, they've won 7 of their last 8 to snatch the minor premiership and get through to the grand final.
That round 10 loss to Collingwood, really the only blip on the radar. The only time for the season they scored under double figure goals. As you said, Jace, won 7 of their first 8. Used 57 players across the course of the season. So really went deep into their stocks there. And I think the significant thing about Casey, they kicked 100 plus points, 9 occasions. They're a scoring juggernaut. And that's a challenge for the Dogs today to try and stop that.
Two informed teams. Casey's won 9 of its last 11. Footscray have won 8 of its last 10. The Doggies coming in on a 20-goal win in the preliminary final. Let's check their finals history at VFL level. And the Dogs, they made the VFL grand final back in 2001 with Werribee. They've won 10 VFL premierships in their history. They won a reserve grade flag in 1994. They were aligned with Werribee. Finals in all those years except one. They were aligned with Williamstown. Finals in all those years. So Brownie, Footscray are its aligned partners, played in every final series this century since 2007.
Yeah, they've been a really successful football club, and 6 players that played in that 2014 premiership are running out there for the Doggies again today.
And some great experience too in this Footscray side. They've got a really good blend of experienced AFL and VFL players, and then some really talented youngsters coming through as well at VFL and AFL level. It's a strong lineup, and it's going to need to be, because the team they come up against this afternoon, the KC Scorpions, have been the pace setters throughout this season. They've had a fantastic year. They've dropped just 4 games. Let's check their finals history. Nudge, you well know it as well as anyone. They were the Springvale Scorpions until 2005.
And inherited a culture of success that was born in the old Federal and Southeast Suburban League. Won premierships perennially through the 80s, 83 in Division 2, 87 in Division 1, and then went on a real run of success through the 1990s.
Yeah, they won a couple of premierships. In fact, they won a bunch of them at the end of the century. And here's some of the key moments, good and bad, in the history of the Scorps.
Well, they say you've got to lose one to win one, and they lost this one from 32 points up in 1990, affected somewhat by the AFL draw in the qualifying final that year that elongated the VFA season. But this was one that a lot of players from a Springvale point of view played in, learnt from, and then went on to really build a dynasty through the back half of the 1990s. Brett Evans, who we see here, kicked 5 goals in the 1995 win over Sandringham. He went on to play in a 1997 Richmond AFL Reserves Premiership with today's Scorpions coach Justin Platt. We see Rod Morgan here hugging a teammate. He was the captain of that 1995 premiership. 12 months later, Graham Yates takes this mark in front of the legend stand at then Optus Oval. Hadn't touched the ball all day. Put the Scorpions in front with 30 seconds to play. KCO Springvale were able to clear the footy from the centre of the ground. David Rees-Jones, who was captain coach of Frankston, took the opposing mark. Time ran short and Springvale had gone back-to-back. Kane Taylor was unbelievable in that game as the Norm Goss medal. That team, incidentally, coached by Brad Gotch in his first year in charge.
That was the golden era for KC, or the Scorpions as they were back then. Springvale, they won 4 flags in 5 years. Since that time, they lost 11 straight VFL finals. They went out in straight sets in 4 years. And part of the reason for that was their alignment was a little bit out of whack at this time of the year, wasn't it? The Melbourne players would go in for surgery or wouldn't make themselves available to play. You referenced earlier on in the broadcast that the combination now has never been tighter. All the Melbourne players putting their hands up, they want to win this premiership.
Well, look at the quality of players they're going to roll out today. In terms of AFL experience, those guys would almost be within their rights to put their hand up and say, we're going off on holiday. But there is some real quality stock in this team today. And I think it says a lot about the character of where the Melbourne Football Club list is going, but also from a KC point of view, guys like Declan Kildee we see on screen there, young guys that have really forged a career in the past 6 months.
Let's take a look at their lineup. 3 ins for this game. Jack Grimes, Liam Hewlett, Dean Turlick in for Morris, Salem and Collis.
And Salem's the story, of course, sustained that concussion in the second quarter last week. We'll have a look at that one shortly. Ed Morris is incredibly stiff. Probably the story in terms of the depth that this team has. Named in the team of the decade for Casey during the year, and unfortunately will be squeezed out of what is a fully stacked deck today for the Scorpions. Dean Turlick, a massive return, suspended off that qualifying final. He took the Dogs apart about 3 weeks ago. 24 possessions, 15 marks and 2 goals, 3. He'll be really significant forward today.
They bat so deep in their midfield and it's all about supplying their key forwards. And this man, Tim Smith, centre forward in the team of the year and the KC team of the decade.
He just competes so hard, and that goal on his left foot early last week was just simply superb. Set the tone for him. He lays tackles inside 50. He creates a contest, and he's done it all year leading from the front.
That AFL quality midfield, and it really is for KC. When you go through the names, as we just saw, real bonus
bonus for them this year, Clayton Oliver. It's not often you get a kid who comes straight into VFL / AFL football and has the sort of physical presence that he has.
An rising star back in round one against GWS, and he's just gone on a real run. Obviously the 13 games, averaging 19 touches in the AFL, but his VFL footy averaging 28 touches a game, and he put that all together last week and in the qualifying final against the Dogs. He's going to be incredibly important for them to stop around the contest today. 28 touches and a goal back in that qualifying final.
Best of field in the prelim last week. 24 possessions, 17 of those contested, 17 tackles, 8 clearances and a goal. It was an incredible game from Clayton Oliver, and he'll have a big role to play again this afternoon. Well, every grand final, there's always disappointment. There's always a hard luck story. And for the Scorps, it's Christian Salem.
Yeah, really disappointing. He couldn't get up from his concussion there. Unfortunately, hit the cricket wicket at Northport Oval there, which is one of the hardest parts on that ground. He did train with them during the week, but just wasn't cleared medically. And he's going to be a loss because he had 12 touches in the first quarter alone last week and really got them going.
He was outstanding. Clearly the best man on the ground when he went down. He's had such a rotten run too with hamstring injuries. He's had that thyroid problem a couple of times. He deserves better, but he's here to support the boys this afternoon. Let's take you down into the Casey rooms now and see their coach, who played 44 AFL games with Richmond and St Kilda. I speak of Justin Platt. Here he is with Nick Carnell.
Puppy, the day's upon us. There's a real sense of composure here at the moment. You'll start favourites this afternoon. Will you touch on that with the players at all?
Look, I think, Nick, the big thing for us is going to be just doing what we've been able to do throughout the course of the year. I think that the favouritism's really irrelevant, mate. I mean, we've got to approach the game in the manner that we have every game that we have this year. I know that the excitement, and there's a fair bit going on with grand final day, but we want the players to enjoy that. But look, mate, I think the favouritism, and that's irrelevant, mate. When the ball's been bounced, it's two teams going hammer and tongs, so that's what we're expecting to see.
Grimes and Turlick come back into the side today. Christian Salem didn't come up.
Yeah, look, Christian was probably two or three days off. I mean, it was a pretty nasty one. But, look, he really pushed the boundaries about trying to play this week. We were hopeful, but didn't get up. Grimes, he comes back into the team after being, you know, ill, pulled out of the team with illness last week. And he's going to be a massive in for us. And, you know, he can play a number of different positions. He's a harder body. He's got a lot of experience. So we're expecting to get a big lift out of Grimesy there as well. And Turlick, obviously, coming off the week off with the suspensions, he's had a super second half of the season. So he's going to be massive addition to us.
Well, Puppy, all the best this afternoon. Good luck.
Let's switch focuses now and focus on Footscray. Let's take a look at their lineup under coach Ash Hansen. Two changes for them. Fletcher Roberts, who played in the AFL last night, and Josh Wallace out for Jordan Staley, who comes in to provide some defensive height, and Ling Jong, an incredible comeback.
That's an amazing story. Broke his collarbone only 17 days ago, went in and had surgery. He'll be playing at least a half of football today, which is extraordinary. But we spoke about Casey's experience. Footscray have got plenty of experience of their own. Jordan Russell has had a superb year leading across the half-back line, so they'll need to put a little bit of work into him. And big Tom Campbell, well, the eyes of the footy world will be watching him with the injury to Roughhead last night.
We're going to break these two teams down in the game from every angle over the next 45 minutes in our VFL Grand Final preview show. And here's a man who plenty of eyes will be on this afternoon. He was overlooked in the draft last year. He's kicked 11 goals straight in his 6 games this year. He won't be overlooked again.
Yeah, he's fully on the radar screens after that performance last week. 5 goals in the second half against some quality AFL listed defenders from the Magpies, and he really put them to the sword. His defensive pressure to create for teammates as well was really significant. The good story about Ben Long is he can play at both ends to the ground. We saw him in the NAB AFL Under 18 Championships do a couple of jobs for the Allies in defence, so he's genuinely a player who can go to either end of the ground.
19 years of age, completing year 12 at Melbourne Grammar this year, the nephew of Michael Long, and certainly he's elevated himself onto the draft radar. Well, we spoke about how good the Casey midfield is. Guys like Mitch Honeychurch and Lucas Webb with a huge role to play today. Mitch has just been such a consistent player at this level.
Yeah, his grunt work in close is going to be really important today. He just, every single week, he finds the football and gets in the best. Last week, 23 disposals and kicked 2 goals, 3. He can kick goals too. Well, he has shots on goals. He's hasn't been too accurate in front of goals, but had a superb VFL year as always.
And his 2 games against Casey this season, he's had 32 and 28 possessions, and they'll need him to get plenty of the football this afternoon. There is Mitch Honeychurch as he prepares for the VFL Grand Final. Right, the big talking point of the week for Footscray The nervous talking point of the week for Footscray was Liam Nash. A big hit on Jordan Kelly last week in the preliminary final. Here it is.
Yeah, we can see it there. It was a massive front-on hit there. He would have been nervous Sunday night. I don't think he would have got much sleep. Got the one-week suspension on the Monday afternoon, and Footscray decided to challenge. They decided they had a case to answer for, and he got cleared. So fantastic that he's out here playing today.
And he provides an X factor, doesn't he, in that midfield. He attacks the ball and the man at 100 miles an hour. He's just that little bit of extra bite that the Doggies need in close.
Yeah, certainly. He's really important, not just because they got him off, but he sets the tone physically for him with his tackling and pressure, and he can take a mark and kick a goal as well.
If Liam Nash and Clayton Oliver are going at the football this afternoon, look out. That will be one to watch. Let's take you down into the Footscray rooms now. A man who played 78 AFL games, including a couple of grand finals and a premiership for West Coast, Ash Hansen, the Footscray coach. Here he is with Abby Holmes.
Ash, the stage is set for what is certain to be a fantastic grand final. But looking at your team in particular, you've got Roberts and Hamling who are up into the AFL side, which really deprives you of that defensive height.
Yep.
What's going to be the plan to combat Casey's tall forwards?
Stopping the injuries, so first and foremost at the source. And then just support plays. So our defenders working as a unit, not locking down onto one offensive player in particular, and looking to support each other. But if we can have pressure around the ball and not give them any clean entries, it's certainly going to help our defenders stop that, have an impact and intercept the ball.
Are you under any instructions from Luke Beveridge as to the workload of the AFL listed players, such as your ruck stocks and Lin Jong?
Not at all. And it's a great feeling going into this game, knowing that where full systems go, we're full throttle to win this game of football, which is really exciting. And I think that's a reflection of our club and where we see the VFL program and where we see this team. And hopefully the importance of building on the momentum from last night and carrying it on again today throughout the course of the next week.
Well, the club is flying. Best of luck here today.
Thanks, Abby.
Good job.
Great to hear two teams going full throttle to win this premiership. Well, joining the conversation on social media on Twitter, at 7VFL. And if you have to leave the house and if you're out and about, or if you've got a friend outside of Victoria, you can live stream this game on the Plus 7 Live app. Well, it's not often that a team wins the preliminary final by 20 goals, but we'll go into a grand final as the underdog. But I have a feeling that'll be happening today.
Yeah, I have no doubt that'll be happening, which is quite extraordinary. Let's see what the market's doing with Matty Campbell at CrownBet.
Despite the Bulldogs destroying the Magpies by 119 points in the prelim final, they are the outsiders today at $3.20, with the Scorpions, the team to beat, at $1.40 and well-backed, with the line moving out to 20.5. Whoever you like, place a head-to-head bet, and if your team leads at half-time but loses the match, we'll match your bet with a bonus bet up to $50. For all the details, head to crownbet.com.au, and as always, please gamble responsibly.
Who's been bitten by a mosquito? All of us. We all have been. Not many of us have been bitten by a camel, have we? It's the little things that bite you.
Sammy, you need to freaking listen to this. You understand it?
You understand where I'm coming from? Do ya?
The one thing you've done is you've given yourselves a shot.
You've got to find something from within and you've got to give for the team.
Every single player that now goes into this last quarter has to become a hero. Who's going to put their hand up and become a hero?
Nothing easy to your opponent. Nothing easy. Be hard and unrelenting and uncompromising on the block you're playing on.
Every single player now gets the job done in relation to team.
Right from the word go. Make sure you respond to this. Season is on the line. We need everything going well.
Yes. Roy's got shot.
Thanks so much to all our VFL coaches that have given us wonderful access. As an AFL coach, Luke Beveridge watches on, preparing to see the Footscray Bulldogs go into battle in just over 38 minutes' time. As we welcome you back to inside Eddie Had Stadium, Jason Bennett alongside Nigel Carmody for the VFL Grand Final pre-game show. We'll take you inside the huddle at quarter time and three-quarter time this afternoon with Justin Plappert Casey. We won't take you inside the Footscray huddle. They politely declined to allow us in, but we'll certainly be hearing from Plappy throughout the afternoon. Well, it's been another great year of AFL young talent coming through the VFL and putting themselves on the AFL draft radar. And before the game today, some players certainly had the opportunity to do that. It was the Sandringham Dragons versus the Murray Bush Rangers in the TAC Cup Grand Final. And it was the Dragons finishing the stronger. It was tight all day. And in the end, Sandy getting up by 17 points. Andrew McGrath, who's been discussed as a top five prospect, potentially the number one pick if GWS can orchestrate a deal. He was named best on the ground.
Yeah, 38 possessions, had a magnificent game. Tim Taranto through midfield as well was really impressive. A couple of players who've both split their time between the Sandringham Dragons and APS footy this year, which is always the interesting dynamic for Sandy. They made a run from the bottom part of the eight, so not dissimilar to what the Bulldogs have done in the AFL this year as well. From a Murray point of view, Will Brody was outstanding around the contest. He should be a top 10 draft pick in a couple of months, Simon. One to watch for next year, Charlie Spargo, son of Paul, former Kangaroo, was really impressive too.
Well, every AFL recruiter would have been here this afternoon, and they'll be watching on in our game as well. There's so much good talent coming through the VFL this year, and this man has been hot property for most of the season, Luke Ryan.
Running around for Maribyrnong Park in the Essendon District Football League last year, couldn't make Essendon's VFL list in the pre-season this year, played just the 10 games for the Lions, good enough to win the Fothergill round medal. Hard to see how he's not taken in the first two rounds of this year's NAB AFL draft.
Jamie McNillan type off halfback, maybe even a little bit more dynamic than that. Well, key defenders are hard to come by in modern football, and this man served his apprenticeship under Matthew Scarlett at South Barwon. His first season in the VFL with Geelong, Tom Stewart, averaged 17 possessions a game. Sort of a Sam Fisher type, plays tall and small.
And probably does almost the most valuable stat at AFL level now, takes intercept marks, gets the footy back into his team's hands. He's another very impressive type.
Well, Oscar McInerney's a chance to run out this afternoon and impress one more time for Casey. From Montrose, playing local footy, the big ruckman, 203 centimetres, 100 kilos. His first season in the VFL, he's come into the competition late in the year, won the ATOD medal for best and fairest in the Development League, which is the VFL reserves. And again, good big men are hard to find.
Yeah, rare that you see a player that play that volume of reserves footy and be on the AFL draft radar. But again, Oscar McInerney has shot through the charts to the point where most clubs are looking at him seriously as a draft prospect this year rather than just a rookie.
Robbie Fox from Coburg, interesting sort of a player. He really is a classic utility. He's been used back. He's been used on the wing. He can go forward. He's so athletic. He played state basketball. He's got great run, great vertical leap, great agility. Plays a little bit like a Brad Ebert.
Got the tank, very good aerially, and a very good size as well at 187 centimetres. He's one that probably perhaps more a mature type, might not be for every club just because of his age, but he might have 8 years on an AFL list in him, and I think he'd be a really good option, particularly the way the game's being played now with the rotations cap.
AFL clubs have become a lot more savvy at picking up mature kids, kids who maybe aren't ready at 18 years of age. They may be physically not ready, or they just haven't played enough footy in their junior years, but they get into an elite program and they make an immediate impact. And this man, Sam McLaughlin from Geelong, played local footy at Colac and North Warrnambool, didn't come through the TAC Cup, plays a little bit like a Mitch Duncan. He moved to Geelong to be an apprentice builder, slotted in this year and really impressed.
What I loved about Sam McLaughlin this year is he'd only have usually sub 20 possessions. It was a really good balance, almost 50-50 of inside and outside ball. He was so clean, brought teammates into the game, and when he got a chance to kick a goal, he generally did. We saw him kick two really important goals in that match against Port Melbourne in the final home and away round of the season.
Another young talent we'll see this afternoon. Keep an eye on this man, Declan Kilty, for the Casey Scorpions. Originally from Moe via the Gippsland under-18s. Played a couple of VFL games last year, but really in the Development League, working on his game. This year, his second season in the VFL, played 18 games. He can go back, he can go forward. In that sense, he's a bit like a Tom Lonergan. Athletic, basketball background, great vertical, great hands.
I'd say he's got a better CV than Michael Hartley. We saw what Michael Hartley was able to do this year, going from Coburg to Essendon, and with the amount of footy that the Bombers' defence had to deal with at AFL level as well. The beauty about Kilty, as you said, is he can play in all three zones, kick three goals in round one, didn't kick any goals until the preliminary final last week, comes up and kicks two, takes contested marks. Tools take time. This guy's just about ready.
Real opportunity for him on the big stage at VFL Grand Final Day to see if Declan Kilty can have an impact like he did last week. Well, one man who has had an impact for North Ballarat this year, another big man, Rowan Marshall, originally from Portland via the North Ballarat under-18s, played some local footy at Sebastopol, 201 centimetres, 20 years of age, his second season in the VFL after being North Ballarat's best first-year player last year. He runs like a midfielder, he's got long arms and great reach. His coach up there at North Ballarat said, "I'd love to just stick him in at centre-half back, he could be a gun." That tall utility Jordan Roughhead type.
Mark Gregg would have almost had this as one of his key priorities, I think, in his first year in charge of the Roosters, to see Rowan Marshall transition out of their program into an AFL system. I think he's probably done enough now, and as you said, Jace, that ability to play ruck or key position is so valuable at the moment, and every club's looking for one of those.
dozens more in the mix as well from VFL level. Those seven guys that we mentioned there all off to the state combine. So that means that more than one AFL club has expressed interest in finding out a little bit more about them. So we wish them all the best. But then there's guys like Michael Gibbons and Cade Answorth. The list goes on and on. So much great VFL talent. Well, speaking of VFL talent, let's take a look at our top 10 plays of the year. And there are some absolute rippers. We'll start with this game, Footscray and Casey in round 15, where goals were hard to come by, into the wind to the left of screen. So Andrew Toshevsky-Beckwith decided to run it.
Well, on the day where the Dogs won this match by 1 point, kicking with the breeze at their back in the final quarter, this goal and a goal by Bailey Dale early in the match is essentially what set up the Dogs' win.
The only two goals to the left of screen out of 25 that day. Matt Eagles, if you follow the recruit, he was just being named to the Brisbane Lions list. That was a brilliant goal out of the ruck from Matt. We spoke of Robbie Fox and his athleticism. Well, there it is.
Right on show. That's why you could find him playing on a wing in the AFL next year.
One of the goals of the year last year was Jonathan Simpkin, who kicked it 95 metres. This year, it was Rupert Wills off the back edge of the square.
We get some Antarctic conditions up at Eureka Stadium from time to time. That was certainly the case this day, and this goal's been measured at somewhere north of 100 metres.
It was so good to see Ahmed Saad back in the VFL this season. He won the Frosty Miller Medal for the most goals, and this one, the best of them.
Incredibly creative, maybe the best of his 49 for the season. He was outstanding for the Lions, and he can no doubt help them push to a final spot next year.
We all love a great fend-off. The Don't Argue's been coming part of football vernacular, and that one's the best we've seen all year.
He hit the bullseye. Look at what it was, probably the most impressive thing about a very impressive year in the VFL from Mason
Bailey Rice on the wrong end of that. Robin Nahas, the talented North Melbourne ex-Richmond Werribee player, takes a great hanger at number four. It'll be interesting to see where he plays his footy next year. Delisted by North Melbourne,
some talk that he may return to the borough.
One of the goals of the year from Keenan Poser, the initial intercept, the gather, off balance, banana, goal.
Well, the fact that he was tumbling, I think, helped the momentum and the career path of the ball to try and get through.
Aaron Francis, one of the most exciting young prospects we saw in the VFL this season. This at a critical time of the game against Werribee.
Look, he just provided highlight after highlight after highlight for us this season. There was probably three pieces of play that he did this year that have been worthy of the number two spot there.
Mitch Hannon took two of the marks of the year. This the best of them. Gary Moorcroft-esque. Can we see it again at Etihad this afternoon?
And he did another one against Williamstown earlier on in the season as well. Mitch Hannon's had a pretty impressive final series, kicked those three late goals against Essendon in the semi-final. I mean, we talk about players that are on the AFL draft radar out of the VFL. You've got to add Mitch Hannon's name to that list.
No question about that. Spoken to a couple of AFL recruiters who said they have their eye on Mitch. One of the things we really love about the VFL is the mix of AFL players and VFL players. Now, to understand, the VFL-listed players have day jobs. They're semi-professional footballers. They have to go to work 5 days a week. They have to travel to training. They train three or four times. They get injured. They've got to do rehab on top of their work, make it all. It's a huge commitment.
All you want as a VFL player is to give yourself the chance to line up against an AFL-listed player and go, on my terms, I've done all I possibly can to prepare to play against you, who does this full-time 7 days a week, 12 months of the year.
Classic example of a VFL-listed player who works hard on the tools during the week and then struts his stuff on the footy field on the weekend is Casey's Tim Smith. He's got a big role to play, and Nige caught up with him during the week. And the Scorpions are into their first grand final since 1999, and their first as the Casey Scorpions.
On a lot of occasions, I physically can't at training train to my full potential just for the mere fact that I've had a huge day at work. Usually a typical day is 5:30, wake up, try and get on the road by about 6 o'clock to wherever I'm heading for the day. Usually finish around 3, 3:30, head straight to training, and then get into it from there for the rest of the night.
Epp spirals it towards Smith at 50, and a great one-handed mark.
I've been at the club for 5 years now, and a big thing for me was, you know, we've had success in previous years, but never won a final. And just the way that it was going this year with Puppy around and how Melbourne and Casey were buying in as a one-club mentality was just huge. And you know, I couldn't pass down another opportunity to just be a part of something successful. And ultimately, we all want to win finals and playing grand finals. And that's what drives me at the moment to just keep giving it my all.
Tim Smith, state rep earlier in the season, and that's why. And from 45 metres out, he pumps it through.
It's a huge occasion for the whole club. There's a lot of people behind the scenes that put in a huge amount of time to have the club running and to keep the players on the track. It's a massive, massive thing to be a part of, and I'm sure those guys can't wait to see the result on Sunday. I see this as a year-long commitment I give my all to, and for me, just playing on Sunday, winning will definitely be the highlight of my time at Casey.
Kicks his third. Well played, Tim Smith.
I'd really love to finish it off with the ultimate success of winning grand final.
It's already been a crazy season of NFL. Catch up with it tomorrow morning here on 7. Let's take a look back at round 15 when these two sides played a one-point thriller at the Witten Oval. It was a typically windy day at the Kennel. Casey led by 21 at quarter time with the breeze. Footscray by 17 at the half. Casey by 30 points at three-quarter time. And then the Dogs came storming home with the breeze. They kicked 4-8-1 behind in the last quarter. They hit the front with a behind to Anthony Barry in the final minute to score a one-point win. There's Luke Beveridge inside the Footscray rooms. Just wishes Lucas Webb all the best. Gets around to all the players. Such a great two teams, one club mentality in both these clubs, Nudge, between Footscray and Casey and Melbourne and the Western Bulldogs. There really is a closeness about the two groups that have been brought together, and it's so important to build a social bridge between the groups, isn't it?
Inextricably linked both clubs, and been so impressed with what Footscray have done for the Western Bulldogs. The VFL program, that 2014 premiership, we're seeing the flow-on effect of that at AFL level without a doubt, and also the capacity of players to float back and forth. It's been really seamless. Zane Cordy and Joel Hamling had played 10 games for the season. The last of those were that round 15 match against Casey. What they've done at AFL level since, they were the best last night in the prelim. They've been brilliant. Right there, hits the nail on the head that it's working for them.
Definitely is. Let's take a look at the keys to this game. Let's start breaking it down from every angle. We're going to start with the Casey attack versus the Footscray defence. The Casey attack ranked one in the competition, averaging 102 points a game, which is absolutely outstanding. The inside 50 to goal conversion, pretty good. They're ranked fourth in the competition once they get it in there. Their accuracy is ranked eighth. They take some marks on the lead, the likes of Smith and Wiedemann. They've kicked 100 points in nine of their 20 games. Mind you, only one of the last four. That was Footscray in the qualifying final. But what they do have, Brownie, is a wonderful blend of talls and smalls in their top five leading goal kickers. They've got the talls in Liam Hewlett, Tim Smith, Sam Wiedemann, then a couple of smalls in Scott and Turlick. It's really well balanced.
It's really efficient, and they move the ball really quickly off the half back line, get it in there one-on-one to those talls. And a couple of those guys, Wiedemann and Hewlett, first-year players, have just been absolutely sensational, you know, kicking 28 goals, and they're very, very accurate in front of goals as well. So that's going to really test the talls off Footscray in Staley and Barry, and they need to try and keep Jordan Russell accountable because he's been so, so good for them across the half back line this year.
And one thing they do is share the load superbly. They have 11 goal kickers in the game against Footscray in that qualifying final, so they do separate the defence. Let's take a look at the Footscray defence while we're talking about it. Ranked 8th in the competition throughout the home and away season, 12th for the rebound 50 rate. They conceded 100 points, 5 of 21, but just one of their last 13, that was against Casey in the qualifying final. And you mentioned Jordan Russell. When you look at their leading rebounders, Nudge, it really is all about Jordan Russell. He's had 99 for the year. The next best, just 39, Anthony Barry and Brad Lynch.
He simply can't be left unaccountable today. It's going to be one of the keys, I would have thought, for Justin Plapp and his coaching staff to identify how they neutralise his impact to not only intercept Mark, but also then rebound and be part of those scoring chains. He's had a pretty handy understudy this year in Brad Lynch, who's come in year one and played 21 games.
And they do have great users in the back half, Brownie. They like to chip it around, get it to a position where they can attack, and then when they go hard.
The open expanses of Etihad Stadium will really help Footscray think. They've been playing the last few weeks at Northport Oval, which is quite short. There's not too much space out wide. So coming here, there'll be so much space for those halfbacks, and particularly Lynch, to run, carry, and use his creativity.
We've already mentioned their lack of tall defenders. No Roberts or Hamling. They are aggressive at zoning off their direct opponent. So the key today for Casey is to try and separate them.
Yeah, full ground press, and they do it as good as anybody. So if you can, you need to use quick ball movement, try and get it through there as quickly as possible, and then all the space will be at the back for those one-on-one contests for the Casey forwards.
Let's flip our focus to the other end of the ground now. Let's take a look at the Footscray attack, ranked 6th in the competition, averaging 87 points a game. They got very poor inside 50 to goal conversion, and their scoring accuracy is the worst in the competition. So historically throughout the year, that tells you that they're going to need to generate more inside 50s in the opposition to score. They kicked 100 points on 6 occasions this season, 3 of their last 5, and last week, well, they kicked the sweep 27-19 against Collingwood. So they've got plenty of forwards who have had plenty of football and kicked plenty of goals, so they'll be high on confidence.
No tools in their top five scorers, though. Completely different setup to Casey. They're all small, medium, dangerous targets.
Which I think from there for Ash Hansen, he'd be throwing the keys to Tom Campbell today. He might be looking at an AFL Grand Final spot next week, depending on Jordan Ruffhead's condition. But I imagine he has to spend some significant time forward today and hit the scoreboard as well. A goal in both the semi and prelim final, but 7 from 7 for the season.
They generally can't survive by just bombing it in, Brownie. They have to go take the short option, try and separate the opposition defence. They kicked had 13 goal kickers against Essendon in the final 2 weeks ago, 14 last week against Collingwood. It's got to be death by a thousand cuts.
Yeah, it does. And they rely a little bit on their midfield kicking some goals. Lucas Ware plays high half forward midfield. He chimes in, as does Bailey Dale, Jamison, those guys.
Last week, Ben Long.
It's not your traditional forward setup, but it has been relatively effective so far this year.
They're coming up against the number one defence in the competition, Casey, averaging just 61 points a game against for the season, which is the best defensive performance since the VFL went to an 18-game season back in 2003. They have been absolutely outstanding. They rebound the football very well and conceded 100 points just twice this season. That was in round 3 to Williamstown and round 6 to Sandringham, and they actually won that round 6 game. They have got such experience and knowledge in that back half. And take a look at some of these names. Lyndon Dunn is their leading rebounder at 75 with an 86% kicking efficiency. You've got Colin Garland, who's had plenty of AFL experience. Mitchie likewise. And then Jack Hutchins, the skipper, is their top four rebounders.
Incredibly cohesive. And the understanding, the shared experience that they have in that back six is what's taken them so far this year. Dunn and Garland are absolute keys today. If Lyndon Dunn's allowed to play almost the Jordan Russell role for Casey today, that'll take the scorps a long way.
So that's the question. Can Footscray keep their attack small and mobile and try to exploit all the tools in the back half? We've spoken of the experience. You throw in Mitch White there as well. They get good midfield support that pushes back into their defensive 50. And Joel Smith's been a really important addition. He was very impressive last week with his athleticism. We'll take a look at the midfield battles as our VFL Grand Final pre-game show continues from Etihad Stadium. And what a week we've got ahead of us. The AFL Grand Final week. You'll see so much of the action right here on Seven, kicking off tomorrow night with the Brownlow Medal.
Times have changed, but the values of the Brownlow Medal never change.
At 5 from the Fremantle Football Club.
It's awarded to the fairest and best player in the Australian Football League. Who will be immortalised this year? Will new cat Patrick Dangerfield be too good?
No Paddy, no Paddy!
Or will it be one of the strong field of elite players hot on his heels? We'll find out on September 26th. The Brownlow Medal, football's night of nights. Live and free on 7.
Welcome back to Etihad Stadium. The 2016 VFL Grand Final is approaching. We're under 14 minutes. It's the Casey Scorpions taking on the Footscray Bulldogs for the VFL Premiership. Let's take you down inside the Casey Scorpions rooms now. Here's their coach, Justin Flapp.
We spoke about this last week. It's not a matter of if, when. Is it going to happen? It'll happen. It'll happen. But we've got to be prepared to work for it. We've got to pay a price. All right? They pay the price. Right, Christian paid the price last week. Someone will have to pay the price. That's the reality of the game, isn't it, O? All right, you ready to go?
Yeah.
Let's go.
Yeah, boys, we're trying not to play the game with your heads down. We've got a bit of nervous energy in the room. Just relax. Yeah, we normally do.
So the Western Bulldogs and Footscray have made a name for themselves with Danny McGinlay doing their banners this year. And today's his horoscope for today, Scorpio, you'll lose your grand final.
It's just been brilliant, hasn't it? He's a comedian in his spare time, and it's good to see a bit of character.
So here's the Bulldogs. They've had a fantastic run leading into September, as we said. They've won 8 of their last 10 games. They're 14-7 for the entire season. Finished the home and away season in 4th position. Let's take a look at the two midfields. We'll start with the inside game. Both these teams have experienced old-school ruckmen with presence. Jake Spencer will go up against Minson and Campbell. Casey like the contested game. They're great at winning it in close, and both teams like to tackle.
Casey love winning the ball in close, and Footscray have the real advantage, the little bit of leg speed if they can get the ball out. So that's going to be an intriguing battle about how the coaches work out ways around it.
In round 15, the tackle count 131 to 95. 226 tackles. Are we going to see that hand-to-hand combat today, or is it going to open up?
I think we'll get a good balance of both. I think the venue helps, but it's a grand final, and it's just the style of play that I think that'll bring that out. The key question for me is the leading tackle for Casey, Jimmy Munro, can play a run-with role as well. It'll be interesting to see whether Justin Platt's prepared to just lock down on one of those quality Dogs mids.
Once it gets to the outside, both teams high disposal rates. They throw it around. Casey like to kick it long. They've got off those leading forwards. They go direct. The Dogs prefer to retain possession and chip it around.
When you've got three key forwards that can really take good marks like Hewlett, Wiedemann and Smith can, you've got to get the ball in there quickly, whereas Footscray like to craft it a little bit more, be a little bit more patient, chip it around it and find little dart-up leads.
So the key question is, who brings that greater midfield intensity for four quarters? Is it going to be close, hand-to-hand in the trenches? Will it open up? And from a Footscray perspective, can they slow down Casey's forward 50 entries and can they speed up their own?
Yeah, that is a really key question. I suppose if it's level supply today with what the Casey forward lines produce this year, you think it's enough for them to win. So it's a question of, do the Dogs win it at the source, use it well enough on the outside, and then through that medium-sized forward line, produce a winning score?
We've seen the two conversions inside 50 to goals. Brownie, as Nudge says, they need to win the inside 50 count, the Dogs, today. They've got to give their forwards more opportunities. It was 44 inside 50s apiece in the qualifying final, and Casey kicked 20 goals to 8.
Yeah, that was an unbelievably efficient day that day, but I believe Ash Hansen has spoken about that day. It got to about 5 goals, 30 points, and he almost put the cue in the rack with one eye towards the semi-final. So he says don't read too much into that 70-point loss.
And it's a very different team. 7 players have come into the side from that day to today. Ling Jong back in the lineup, and as we've seen right throughout September, the Bulldogs, they love being underdogs.
Yeah, they thrive on it. And it's also significant today, this grand final, they haven't held anyone over. This is the first game this VFL team goes into unencumbered by what's happening with the AFL side's final still.
So here come Footscray, the start of a very, very exciting week for their success-starved fans, and plenty have made the trip to Etihad Stadium today. Some of them, no doubt, from Sydney overnight with very little sleep, but here to support their boys this afternoon.
And big headaches, I would think. It would have been a fun bus trip on the way back. I would have loved to have been on that bus.
Footscray and Casey for the VFL Premiership. Great to have you with us live on 7. Two great teams, very worthy combatants. And after the break, we'll see them go at it for the VFL Premiership of 2016. Stay with us. The grand final coming your way right after this.
Days like today are what you play for. You realise how elusive they are. Some players have never had the privilege to run out on grand final day. These players do. That's why they need to treat every single contest, every minute, every second, that could be the difference between their side winning and losing. The side that wants it the most, the one that's prepared to pay the price and it can execute under pressure, will be the side winning today. Opportunities like this don't come around very often. You've got to take them.
Welcome back to Etihad Stadium. It's the 2016 VFL Grand Final. It's Casey taking on Footscray. And we've got just under 6 minutes until the opening bounce. Jason Bennett alongside Campbell Brown as Mike Brady wraps up his rendition of One Day in September, one of the great traditions of our great game.
It's a great anthem, isn't it?
There's Mitch Honeychurch alongside Jed Adcock.
Jed Adcock, he's going to be really important today as we see all the boys up there in the box. They wouldn't have got a whole lot of sleep last night. Really exciting time heading into their first grand final. They're here to support a lot of their teammates.
There's Clayton Oliver. We've spoken about the significance of him this afternoon. Really tough, physical, inside, ball of a midfielder.
Well, 17 tackles last week really sums it up. He had 8 clearances, 24 touches. He was simply superb. He did all the grunt work for Casey last week, and that man, not only did he kick the 6 goals in just his 6th VFL game, he did a couple of really hard, tough things that really would have caught the eye of a lot of recruiters. So he got overlooked last year. There is absolutely no doubt whatsoever they won't make the same mistake twice, Jase.
Well, they've been the pace setters all year, Casey. They've sat on top of the ladder for 14 of the 21 weeks. They're ranked number one in attack and defence, and they'll start as favourites this afternoon. But there's the Bulldogs. And there's been a sense of destiny around this club over recent weeks. Can they kick off AFL Grand Final week with a VFL Premiership and have 2 trophies in the cabinet by this time next week?
Well, their self-belief is the big thing. They believe every single time they go out there to play that they can win it. Doesn't matter who they put on the park and if they're underdogs or not.
So the two teams coming together for the pre-game ceremony, as we take you down to our master of ceremonies, our own Nigel Carmody.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 2016 Peter Jackson VFL Legendary Grand Final between the Casey Scorpions and Footscray. Can you please join the players, coaches and umpires and be upstanding for the Australian National Anthem to be performed by the one and only Mike Brady.
Australians, all let us rejoice, for we are young and free. We've golden soil and wealth for toil. Our home is girt by sea. Our land abounds in nature's gifts of beauty, rich and rare. In history's page, let every stage advance Australia fair. In joyful strains, then let us sing. Advance Australia fair.
One of the great moments in any footballer's career at any level. Campbell Brown, you experienced it 2008 with Hawthorn as a player. What's going through your mind right now?
Oh, it's goosebumps standing there side by side with your arms linked with your teammates, about to go into the biggest game of your life. And really, it's about the next few minutes. It's just about staying calm. The leaders do a really good job of that, just coming out and you know your role and you just want to go out there and execute. It's not necessarily about getting some early touches, things like that. If you're a defender, it's about structuring up properly, maybe doing a really good defensive act. The midfield battle is going to be so important, so every single contest is going to be crucial in there. But it's some guys let the moment get the better of them and they can't perform to their maximum capability on the big stage, and others just love it.
The two captains coming together, Jack Hutchins and Jordan Russell, both wonderful leaders at this level. The Dogs will win the toss. Kick to the right of screen in the opening term. 259 games of experience between our three field umpires this afternoon. Congratulations to Hayden Gavine, Daniel Butcher, Heath Ryan, James Davey, the emergency. Our boundary umpires, Ben McDonald, Nick Lawrence, Patrick Deneen and Damien Main. And our goal umpires, Dylan Benwell and Matthew McClure. Well done to all of you gentlemen on achieving the ultimate in VFL umpiring. There's Jack Hutchins and there's Jordan Russell.
Well, he was in this exact same position a few years ago, had the captaincy and led them to their 2014 premiership, so he knows what it's like, as do five other of his teammates that played that day, including Ling Jong, who must be Superman. Broken collarbone only 17 days ago, and he's right in the frame for an AFL call-up.
Must be a very fine line between being emotionally aroused and not going over the top and just focusing on your mind's racing and your adrenaline's racing, focusing on the job at hand.
There's a fine balance, but a lot of these guys, you pick that up with experience. And a lot of these guys out there today have played a lot of VFL, AFL football. It's more important for the young guys not to get too overawed, and that's where it's really important for the teammates around them, just to make sure that we see the players getting straight into Ling Jong, and I'm sure they'll test out his left collarbone. There's no doubt at all.
Both these teams, as we said, blessed with great leaders. Good crowd in. Bottom two tiers of Etihad Stadium filling up nicely. These two popular teams, the Casey Scorpions, who are aligned with Melbourne, and the Footscray Bulldogs out of the Witten Oval. Welcome to the 2016 VFL Grand Final, live on 7. Good luck to Casey and Footscray, and may the best team win. It'll be Will Minson versus Jake Spencer at the opening bounce. Two old-fashioned ruckmen. The bounce favoured Spencer. Oliver with an early touch. Works it to Grimes. And now wide off half-back. He goes to the wing and delivers to Kennedy. Just some of the midfield class that Casey have out there this afternoon. Ben Kennedy, the former Magpie, towards half-forward. Alex Neil-Bullen, who's had a sensational season at VFL level. Not so that kick. It'll be picked off by the veteran, Barry. To Russell under pressure from Grimes.
They disguise that really well then. Russell, that's experience for you. Was a player in the area, but a really poor kick inside 50 by Neil-Bullen.
Plenty of players around this stoppage looking for an early touch. Spencer and Minson lock up. Dalgleish floats a handball to Honeychurch, but he's hot. Taken straight down by Mitch White and slammed into the turf. Minson works to the front. Grimes a fumble, Minson takes it, throws it on the boot, just enough to get it towards Dalgleish. Webb a slight fumble, he's confronted and taken down by Mitchie. In fact, it's Matt Jones in over the top, we'll have another bounce. This is what we saw in round 15, it was a really close hand-to-hand combat kind of a game.
That's how Casey prefer to play their football.
And the Dogs wriggle free. Stevens, awkward one for White, left it behind. Honeychurch in there trying to reef it out. Webb, he's muscled off the football. Honeychurch, quick give to Dalgleish. Kicks towards half four, the mark taken by Hannon. He'll get it and go. Hannon will dish it off to Lynch, who's got a raking left boot. Wants to twist and turn. Gives it to Russell. He moves past Newton, delivers inside 50 and hits Dale. Nice patient build-up from the Dogs. They got it in the experienced hands of Jordan Russell, and he knew what to do.
And this man has got a really good record against Casey. Kicked three goals against them earlier in the year. He finds the footy, such a smart player in his second season.
And that's how the Dogs like to play their football, isn't it? Get it out into space, move it quickly, and hit up a mobile target. And Bailey Dale has kicked 19-17 for the season. Prodigious young talent. And he kicks the opening goal of the grand final.
Really important bit of play by Mitch Hannon. He played on, realised there was no one to kick to, so he came in board, gave it to Lynch, who went backwards again, just bought his forwards 4 or 5 seconds, and the kick inside 50 by the skipper. Russell was superb.
Bailey Dale, the first Dog to 20 goals this Peter Jackson VFL season. It's experience only in the circle. Minson grabs it, drop kicks it forward in the end. Honeychurch came to meet it. Toted it off the ground. It's flicked by Mitchie. Wants to find White. Good pressure there from Hamilton. Mitchie had the presence of mind to flick it back. The athletic Smith had it chopped off. The Dogs get another opportunity. John tests out the collarbone. Can release Jamison, who's also been a goal kicker. He'll shoot long in the Hannon direction on the stretch. Hutchins there to deny him.
That's going to be a great matchup. The captain, Jack Hutchins, VFL fullback of the year on the exciting Mitch Hannon.
Casey quick to take it in. Garland will combine with Jack Grimes back into the side after being ill last week. And here's Wiedemann on the lead. Anthony Barry turned 30 on Friday against him. Kennedy set wheeling with some early ball. Finds Trengove. So the Melbourne listed keys for Casey linking up early. Trengove. Smith couldn't finish it off. Now the Dogs go to work. Jong denied though. Smith keeps it alive. Oliver will take on the contest. Just tried to flip the handball for Wiedemann. Smith dives in. Hot footy early in this grand final. That's how Oliver likes it. Mitchie's got a runner outside. It's Jones. He taps it forward. Spencer denied. Turlick wreaked havoc in the qualifying final. Gets through a couple. Can release a man. Goal perhaps coming up for White. Yes! Casey with their first strike.
Just couldn't make the tackle stick. Firstly, Oliver and that one on Turlick. They broke the tackles. Got the handball out to White. There was a classy finish.
Entertaining start to the 2016 VFL Grand Final. Goal apiece after 5 minutes. Campbell into the ruck against Spencer. Campbell with a secondary tap. Oliver tracks it at ground level. Handball to Smith and now back to Oliver, who leaves it behind. Taken by Jamison. He goes towards Long, confronted the other way by Neil Bullen. Gets the handball free. Stevens had it momentarily. Taken by Grimes, and now they've got a couple of outside runners. Trengove to Kennedy through traffic. Draw some attention. Hewlett, slight fumble. Trengove confronted by Smith. Good scrambling defence from the Dogs, and they'll be happy with that stoppage.
Yeah, they did well there, Footscray, because Casey were out running in waves, and a couple of players, defenders for Footscray, just came off their men. Risky, but they managed to create a ball up.
Spencer the tap. Effective down to Grimes, who tumbles a kick towards 50. Barry mown down in a strong tackle by Wiedemann. Umpire will call for a ball up.
Good of physicality, nice and early. Nothing over the top, but just good hard tackling.
Third man up is Trengove. Smother ricochets to Spencer. Quick kick inside 50 from Neil Boland. Here's an opportunity.
for the Scorps. Neil Bullen ran into some traffic, lost the football. Newton tries to barge his way through. Smith lurking within 10 at the top of the goal square. Again, the Dogs scramble. And again, they hang on. There's Justin Platt, coach of the Scorpions, the minor premiers for the first time since 2012. Spins his tap, pinched by Hamilton. Dangerous kick back towards the 50. Tap on from White was effective. Ben Long came in hard on Kilty. Neil Bullen, Long tries to bust through. Grimes gets a piece of him, takes him down. It's Stevens. Jamison dispossessed. Hamilton likewise. Tough to get an easy kick in there at the moment as we head down to Ab.
Guys, Clayton Oliver has come to the bench early with what looks like a little niggle to the right knee. So he's in the hands of the medics, and I'll keep an eye on that one for you.
Thanks, Ab. Three possessions already for Clayton Oliver.
Just really good contested football at the moment. Both sides not allowing any time and space.
Everything you want from a grand final. Get things going. Dogs with a one-point lead. Hamilton forced just quick kick down the line. Long and done. And experience will win the day. And Long almost giving away a 50. Approaching after Lyndon Dunn took the mark. So he's been the architect behind the footy for Casey this season. And will do so again. Switch play to his partner in crime in Garland. He's got White running for him. He'll dance around Will Hayes and bring the ball back into the corridor. So Casey almost with a Footscray game style in the last 30 seconds. Hutchins, first year captain, back to Dunn, who's basically just camped where he had the original kick in this sequence. This time will be forced to launch long down the line. Flies are plenty. Wiedemann brings it to ground, denies Campbell, and Neil Bullen will be stopped in his tracks.
I think the defenders there for Casey were just enjoying the extra space that they probably haven't had for the last month on Northport Oval. Good bit of defensive work by Footscray not to allow the switch.
McInerney the tap, but it went to Lynch. Stevens can't get through the tackle. Here's McInerney to tidy up again. Quick hands, ends up with Trengove to Grimes. His kick was smothered off his boot. Greenwood comes hard one way, Kennedy the other. Honeychurch in over the top. Umpire hovers and says holding the football.
Very unlucky there. Kennedy was superb in that battle with Greenwood.
Honeychurch to Jamison. Called to go. Uncertain of his options. No one leading towards him, so he's going to have to kick it long towards half forward. Dunn read it off the boot. Attacked the contest, got rid of Stevens and took it to the line. And the long bombs to 50 today are manna from heaven for the likes of Lyndon Dunn and Jack Hutchins.
Well, Ben Long is playing on Lyndon Dunn there. You could just see one only playing his seventh VFL game, and Lyndon Dunn just read the ball there. He didn't worry about his direct opponent. He just came and attacked the contest and killed the ball over the boundary line.
Vincent, deft little tap towards Honeychurch, but it ricocheted to McInerney. Here's Dale, good hands to Nash. He gets a look at the goal face, pushes it just across and off the hands of Dunn, over and through for a minor score as we head down to Ab.
Clayton Oliver is back on the ground, guys. That right knee is all good to go.
Thanks, Ab. 11 Dogs without a touch so far as Dunn, who's had a mountain of it, as has Jack Grimes. Back from that illness last week, this will be seventh possession already. Looked for Garland, chopped off by Hayes. Two-on-two contest, kept alive by Garland. Scorps doing better on the inside. Kennedy, McInerney a long way down from 203. Clean pickup, and Kennedy pops a high one on his fellow SA product, Bailey Williams.
That was a brilliant pickup there by Oscar McInerney, below his knees, 203 centimetres.
Casey continue to be happy to go back on the 45-degree angle to get out the other side. Done. He'll execute the kick. And set running now, Munro. Kick was shallow and allowed the Russell fist to get in. And Jordan Russell at the moment still getting it on his own terms, it has to be said, Campbell. There's been no real concerted option from a Casey point of view to try and lock down on him so far.
Unless you put a defensive forward on him, which a lot of clubs are reluctant to do because it interferes with your team defence, he'll just be able to zone off as he pleases.
Bailey Dale and Mitch White, the goal kickers so far for the respective sides in the 2016 decider. An air swing from Trengove and Oliver. Healthy and back into the action.
Oliver and Nash, we spoke about it pre-game. There's a loose ball in dispute between those two. Don't get in the way. Campbell. Bounce beat White. Tracking it back is Munro. Nice shepherd from Kielty. He gets it to Hutchins. Steps around Jamison and kicks towards half forward. Smith tried to work the other Smith under the ball. This is Tim Smith for Casey. Handball was pinched by Williams. Off half back, beautifully smothered by Trengove. Nash, thundered into by Grimes. Hannon wins the football. Hamilton to Williams. The Dogs again look to spread from half back. This is Barry. He's got a man over the top. Staley to Greenwood. Looks up to 50. Wants a target. Coming out to meet it was John. Couldn't take the mark. The ground level, it's picked up by Hannon. Onto his left boot. Good vision. Puts it into the path of Honeychurch. We'll get there on the bounce. Mitchie will arrive to try and corral him. So Honeychurch will bring it back inboard. It was well read by Oliver. He links up with Newton. And now they're away through Trengove.
The kick's a bit deep for the Casey Ford line. It'll be a foot race. Tyshevsky Beckwith will win the day. Take on Tim Smith to find Rourke Smith. Now Williams, who just cues. It's a half volley forward for Adcock. An early touch for the former Lion. Flying in his long. A fist from Dunn at ground level. And the Scorpions can launch again. Smith, Trengove by hand. Back to Smith, has that athleticism and can release Mitchie. What's he got forward of the footy? A man in the back in Wiedemann. And he's got a passage to kick the second for the Scorps.
Really shallow inside 50 entry from Jed Adcock. Almost panicked. Lyndon Dunn spoils it and they just run straight through the corridor. They link up like Casey do and find Wiedemann, who's had a terrific first season out in the back.
So 13 and a half minutes gone. 2-1 in favour of the Scorpions. Here's Campbell out of the ruck. Skins a kick forward inside 50. Dale was half a chance. Stevens taken down. It opens up for Long. Can we see some magic here? Gets around Newton. Gives a little handball. It's an awkward bounce for Dale. He'll go back and fetch it now. Tries to keep it moving, only as far as Trengove. Here's Neil Bullen, just slams it on the boot. Only as far as Adcock, who can deliver from 40 metres out. He tugs the kick off the hands of Hannon. And through for another minor score.
It was great forward line pressure, though, by Footscray, just to force that hat kick out. Fell into the arms of Adcock and just couldn't quite finish off one step.
And done with the kick in. Mentioned in AFL trade talks during the week. He's had a fantastic season at AFL level, at VFL level rather.
He's still contracted for the year, but Brisbane right into him.
Free kick to the Dogs. This will come back to Bailey Williams. Plays on, gains a couple of metres and then pumps it inside 50. Campbell pushing to position. Got his hands to it. Dunn quickly to Newton. Quick kick off the hands of Tyshevsky Beckwith. Staley at the back. Can deliver short.
Smart kick. And that's what they need to do. If they continue to just to bomb the ball long and high inside 50.
Adcock from outside 50. Looking for the give.
Dunn and Colin Garland. Guys like that, Hutchins, who have a few day taking intercept marks. It feels like he's looking around, but he's got the journey in him here, Chet Adcock.
A kick from just outside the 50. Makes good contact, but he's pushed it to the right-hand side. Campbell's there, but it's cleared the line. Minor score to the Dogs.
It's 1-4. They've had some opportunities so far in this first quarter.
Inside 50's 9-4, but we've mentioned their conversion pre-game.
We've got an attempted barrel from Dunn, a chaos ball, if you will. And it's going to work for the Dogs because Greenwood can scissor off a handball to Lynch. Staley inboard. Ferreira on the scene. Couldn't deny Barry. Five-time premiership player with Franks and YCW made it his. Finds Honeychurch, who came off his line. Lowers the vision. Casey back there in number. Can it get to the back for Hannon? He's got Dunn for company. It pinballs around eventually to Dunn. Oliver. And they'll get out. Newton, Kennedy. That handball had just too much on it for the leaping Trengove.
The last two inside 50s, Barry and Staley, have just lowered their eyes and hit that little lead-up target, but they're finding him 55 metres out, which is just a fraction too far.
Jack Trengove, fellow former Melbourne co-captain Jack Grimes, a big part of this Casey push for their first premiership in 17 years. Spencer off to Oliver, who's getting busy, tumbles his kick forward. Good work at the back from Staley, who's really important today. Young player, spent time with North Ballarat, needs to give them something defensively. His kick inside 50. Hutchins flew high. Campbell was pushed out of the contest. Munro corralled by Adcock. Off to Smith. Here's Long's opportunity. Only needs a little window. Gets boot to ball. Will fade across the line. Another behind of the Dogs. They're peppering, but no real damage done so far.
There's great forward line pressure again. Long just fumbled. Needed to be a little bit cleaner there to buy himself another second or two and snap that through.
So the Dogs continue to hammer away. Here's Oliver. to Kennedy. Awkward kickoff balance. It hugs the line and crosses it out of bounds on the full. So once again, the Dogs successful at this half ground press that they've got.
Casey just really struggling to get the ball out of their defensive half of the ground at the moment.
Inside 50s now, 11-4. Casey lead the game. It's what we thought might happen pre-game. It's pretty standard for the Dogs. The conversion, once they get it inside 50 to goals, isn't great. They need lots of opportunities. Barry's kick to Williams. Good hunting from Turlick. But Barry gets it back, gives it to Lynch. Wants to switch play. Aggressive kick opens up the corridor here for Jamison. He delivers a searing kick towards Hannon. Good defensive pressure from Kilty. Forced the turnover as Oliver gets it to Jones. Jones off half back. Goes towards Neil Bullen. Got to sit and wait. Stevens attacked it and took the mark. Wants to move it on quickly by hand to Shevsky Beckwith. Goes for a run. Has a bounce. Can he sneak away from Neil Bullen? He cannot. An advantage will be paid. It'll come back the other way. Mitchie to Jones. Now Kennedy runs to 50. Man over the top is Ferreira. Well played, Alex Neil Bullen. Ferreira can go short and hit Hewlett 15 metres out from goal.
Well, they're the things that win your games of football and win your premierships. Alex Neil Bullen outmarked on the wing, but he stayed in the contest. There was a quick play of the ball, and he never gave up. Toshevsky Beckwith is so quick. We've seen all year his wheels, and Alex Neil Bullen turns a certain inside 50 against into a scoring opportunity the other way. Big play.
What an exciting prospect this man is. Liam Hewlett, the 19-year-old from Seaford and St Bede's, Luke Beveridge's old club. He's kicked 28-14 for the season in the VFL. One to watch for Melbourne fans in the future. And he misses from point-blank range.
A bit stuttery there from Liam Hewlett. Casey double their margin. Almost a muted hush around the crowd at the moment as they wait to see what's going to unfold in. It's been a real feeling-out process in these first 19 minutes. Jong testing out that collarbone off 17 days. Dogs will go up the centre of the ground and maybe try and slingshot it. Webb, normally a good user, has Minton out the back. Had a runner outside in Dalgleish. Jamison inboard. He'll go the Jamison way now. Been prominent in the finals. Might try and 1-2 it here with Nash. He gets a window of space. Let's fly. And goals. Dogs return to the advantage.
So just Liam Nash's sixth goal for the season. It was well worked from the Dogs. They managed to get through, get that quick ball movement inside 50 before the Casey zone could push back. And Nash finds the middle of the goals and the Dogs have the lead. It's been a time on in the opening term. 2016 VFL Grand Final. Webb leaves it behind, taken by Oliver. Quick kick towards 50s, picked off once again by Jordan Russell. He wants to switch to the outer side of the ground and Hamilton. It's been a promising opening 20 minutes from the Dogs. They've really managed to get the game on their terms early. Kick towards half forward. Dunn attacked it. John couldn't hang on. Hutchins at ground level trying to win the football. It ricochets to Neil Bullen. Quick hands to McInerney. And now he releases Joel Smith. The athletic Joel Smith. Difficult handball for Kennedy. Smith goes back to try and win it. Dogs arrive. Williams to Shevsky Beckwith. And a good turnover for the Dogs. Lynch has it. Prepared to concede and find Barry in defensive 50. Barry goes to a one-on-one. Honeychurch versus Grimes. Honeychurch kept his feet. Runs across the logo centre wing and delivers to Ben Long. Umpire will pay the free kick.
Hold there, East West.
Against Ben Newton.
Stay here.
He's reluctant to go long down the line because Oscar McInerney, oh,
wasn't the option he was looking for. Just didn't hit the kick to Dalgleish. It ricocheted off Honeychurch and Hutchins will tidy it up to Garland. Now Grimes to a two-on-one. Smith outnumbered. Barry got the defensive fist in. Toshevsky Beckwith with the crumb. Coming in hard was Kennedy. It ricochets off Smith, who's pulled up sore. Tim Smith.
Well, there were just so many Casey numbers down the line. That's why Long was a bit reluctant. Tim Smith hobbling after that contest.
Oh, Corky right above the knee.
He's just had the one disposal so far, so they're doing a terrific job in containing him.
Mitchell to Jong. The handball was speculative from Jamison and picked off by Grimes. Trengove goes inside 50. Wiedemann sets himself. It spills to the back. Ferreira couldn't quite take it with him. Wiedemann again involved. Williams quick hands to Barry. He's immediately tackled by Ferreira. Taken to ground. And the umpire will call for a bounce. There's Tim Smith. really nasty knee just above the knee.
Yeah, that'll hurt. Clayton Oliver and Jack Grimes up to 9 possessions apiece already. Kennedy kept it alive for McInerney, who's sandwiched by a number of dogs. Tim Smith, ultra important. We touched on his value to the team. It was almost epitomised in that contest there, where he was able to at least get the ball out in Casey territory. Not a possession, but just keeping in the right part of the ground. Really important piece of the Casey puzzle. Bad bounce for Munro, and that will allow the Dogs to get away. Toshevsky back with Moan down. Viv Michie claims him. And once again, 4 half tackling on show from the Scorpions. Former Docker. Another outstanding season in midfield for the Scorpions. He'll go in the Hewlett direction. Bring it to ground with Smith. Anthony Barry won't be able to come free of the clutches of Ferreira.
So the youngster Toshevsky Beckwith taking on the game from half-back, but run down on a couple of occasions.
Yeah, and look, if you're a coach, you'll encourage that, because more often than not, it's going to keep working for you. The level's just gone up a fraction. He's still getting used to it, but don't discourage it.
Jones backtrack, found some space, goes in the Wiedemann direction. The fist from Russell. Smith, Lynch. Eventually, Rourke Smith can clean it up. The Dogs will get out of harm's way. Hamilton, Jong, navigates his way through traffic. Back to Rourke Smith. Neat play from the Bulldogs, starting to get it on their terms. Hamilton's kick hung, allowed Kilty to get the touch in. It'll find its way to Wiedemann. Greenwood claimed him. Michie does the 360 and it's gone.
Now Toshevsky Beckwith, off half back, quick movement to a wide open 50. Honeychurch goes to ground, earns himself the free kick.
They just play such a bold, brash brand of football. Kept the ball alive in the back pocket there with handball, and most teams, I think, would have been happy just to take it out of bounds.
Goes quickly to Lynch, who finds Hannon. Once again, if they're able to get it inside 50 quickly to those mobile Footscray forwards, it doesn't allow Casey to set up defensively.
And it's high risk, high reward, isn't it? They can be scored against if they don't execute properly, but they just back in their system. Quick handballs out of the back half, bring it through the corridor, and Mitch Hannon one-on-one. He's a very hard man to stop.
19-11 for the season. Really only cemented his spot in the VFL mid-year. On this occasion, he can't make the pay. So the Dogs, 2-6 to 2-1. 25 minutes gone, but only a 5-point lead for all their dominance. Inside 50s now up to 13-7, yet the margin just 5 points.
Lyndon Dunn once again. Will he try the talk for a second time? No. Back to the conventional drop punt. McInerney in the van. Minson brings it to ground level. What will it do here? Keelty took on the body contact. Hewlett can release Newton. Just scissors the kick down the line for Turlick, who's really reverting to type. He's exerted big influence early in this contest already. And we'll take on a risk here. High through the corridor. Body work from Jones on Hayes. In favour Jones. Can release Munro. Check it forward for White to kick the opening goal for the Scorpions. Now he's held onto the footy and the hard running of Jones is rewarded. He'll tumble his kick forward. Ferreira outgunned. Got hands to it. Dogs have the numbers. Smith lost it. Dogs will be happy to create this stoppage as we head downstairs to former Coburg skipper Nick Carnell.
Yeah, James, we saw Tim Smith hobble off a moment ago. He's been assessed by the doctors. Looks like a complaint above the left knee. He's been strapped and looks like he may make a return to the game.
Quick kick out of the congestion from Webb. Awkward bounce, nicely gathered by Kilty's handball, made it tough for Grimes. In came Jong to Honeychurch. Once again, the Dogs look to build off half-back. Here's Campbell. He's got a Hannon tracking back towards the goal square. Goes by hand to Adcock. He waits for the support run of Williams. Campbell kept running. He'll gather at 60 metres from home. Will turn, but the Casey defence have had time to get back in number. And Smith comes across, impacts the contest at ground level. Hamilton, Hayes, Honeychurch run down. And just that hesitation allowed Casey to get the numbers back. And Neil Bullen short to Dunn.
You just need to identify. Mitch Hannon had seen all the space behind him and bolted to the goal square. They just were a little bit slow with their delivery inside 50. And then it was a popped kick nice and high, allowed the Casey defenders to get back and intercept.
Trent Gove to Newton and now Matt Jones. Won a couple of flags at South Croydon before heading to Queensland in his pre-AFL days. Kicks to the wing, Minson over the top with the fist. Lynch at ground level. The Dogs winning plenty of football right now. Jamison to Barry, short to Minson. Kick towards centre half forward. Grimes in best position over the top to force a contest with Stevens. Oliver a bouncing ball. Didn't look too steady on his feet as he attacked it there, Clayton Oliver. And it's at ground level for Adcock to scrap, and the umpire will ball it up.
They're really critical win there for Jed Adcock, just to hold the ball up at centre-half forward. The kick again was shallow by Will Minson, and they were outnumbered there, Footscray. Casey, if they were clean there without Adcock, could have transferred that into an inside 50.
Beautiful tap from Spencer to Trengove, and a chain of handballs now ends with White. He switches play to the opposite halfback flank and finds Matt Jones. He can go down the line, having to stand and wait with Smith. Coming the other direction was Russell to effect the turnover. Honeychurch to Webb. Webb off his left from 55. Great kick over the back of the defensive zone, finds Lin Jong.
Outstanding kick. He's got a big penetrating leg, and the ball just travelled that extra 5 or 6 metres over the top. Nothing Casey could do about that, and the timing was superb right on quarter time. Lin Jong.
Well, the last time we saw Lin Jong, he was sitting on the bench at Subiaco in the elimination final in tears, thinking his season was done with a broken collarbone. And now here he is with an opportunity to get some return on Footscray's investment in the first term, and he hits the post. Sums up the opening quarter for Footscray as Dunn comes in to let him all know all about it.
Oh, it's on here. They're coming from absolutely everywhere. Lyndon Dunn and Lin Jong really going at it. Some feeling in this now. And there's not much the umpires can do because the quarter time siren has sounded. There's Lin Jong at the bottom of that pack. And it's very willing.
And Lin Jong is down. It's still going, spilling over the boundary line. There's still some action involved here. And that was a tinderbox. The slightest spark, and they came from everywhere. They came from the benches. They came from the back line. And finally, the two teams separate. But there's plenty of spice in the VFL Grand Final. And at quarter time, Footscray, who dominated proceedings in the opening term, lead by a kick. It's Footscray 2-7-19. Casey at 2-1-13. Quarter time in the 2016 VFL Grand Final.
Quarter time break brought to you by Woolworths.
Fiery finish to the opening term. Here's Lin Jong after the siren. His kick hits the post. Lyndon Dunn happy to go up and let him know all about it. And that was the spark that just ignited the tinderbox. They came from everywhere at real speed. Lin Jong on the bottom of that pack with the cracked collarbone, and he got a bit of a working over.
Well, they don't hand out premiership medallions. You've got to earn them, and everything is at stake here. Two very passionate clubs trying to win some silverware, which it means everything. And you can see there the players just came from everywhere.
At quarter time, the wasteful, inaccurate Dogs, 2-7-19. Dominated the opening term but didn't stick it on the scoreboard. They lead by a kick, 2-1-13 Casey. Inside 50s, 15-8 in favour of the Dogs as we head down to their coach, Ash Hansen, with Nick Carnell.
Ash, great start. Bit of heat in the contest now. What was your message to the players at quarter time?
Oh, just composure, you know, with our ball use. 9 scoring shots to 3. Says we're doing a lot right. We're just probably going to get more value for our entries at the moment.
You're obviously conscious of the midfield depth of the Casey Scorpions. Your midfield's on top at the moment. You happy with where their things are at?
Yeah, I am. I reckon our boys are really combating well. We've got really good depth through there ourselves, so I'm confident they can get the job done.
Thanks, Ash. Cheers. Thanks, Nick.
A lot to like in that opening term for the Bulldogs, gentlemen, but they didn't stick it on the scoreboard.
They won the inside 50 count, 15-8, 2 goals, 7, 9 scoring shots, and some of those very gettable. They got hurt the other way on a couple of occasions.
There's Clayton Oliver just giving Lin Jong a running fitness test on that shoulder as we start the second term of the VFL Grand Final. Jason Bennett, Campbell Brown, Abby Holmes, Nick Carnell, and here's Nigel Carmody.
You feel like there's a big target on the collarbone of number 46 at the moment. Casey with the first inside 50 of the quarter. Wiedemann denied. Toshevsky Beckwith won't be run down this time. Taps the kick only as far as Jones, who had a pretty dynamic finish to that opening quarter.
He would have had to have expected it coming into today's game. There's no doubt about that.
And Jong's had 7 possessions so far. 6 handballs. His footy at VFL level, as rare as it's been in 2016, has simply been electric. Who knows, maybe more to come in that fairy tale in 6 days' time. The Western Bulldogs, of course, into the AFL Grand Final to face Sydney in a huge week coming up on 7. Starting with the Brownlow tomorrow night, there is Jong. Gets the handball off. The Dogs will try and reset. Inboard for Lynch, who is athletic, will try and use his pace and his kicking depth as well for Hayes. Denied by the fist of Garland. Hannon. Minson will take on Dunn. Hayes will try and keep it alive. Bearing down on him, Garland did well to halve the contest. Hutchins Inboard for White. Scrappy from the Scorpions. Spencer chopped off by Adcock. Dispossessed. Hutchins through traffic. Oliver, superb play. Dunn only knows one thing to do there. That's kick and get it out of trouble. They're set up down the line. Russell once again can bring it down with by fist. Follow up with a kick. It's a torpedo inboard. Hannon too deep for him. Dunn with the fist. The Casey defence getting a workout in the past 60 seconds.
How good's Clayton Oliver in tight spaces, isn't he? Just finds a way through.
Just hits it at speed, doesn't he? Really hits the contest at speed. And more often than not, takes the ball and the man with him. So the Dogs by a goal, early going in the second term of the grand final. Oliver against Jong at the moment in the ruck. Campbell, third man up, unopposed. Stevens, shoulder to shoulder with Newton, and here is Oliver. Runs off defensive 50, kicks long towards the wing. Spills to the back of the contest, and Casey kept their feet. This is Tim Smith running onto it. He's got a man over the top. Hewlett tracking goalward. The kick really wasn't to his advantage. Will it sit? It will. But he'll miss.
Just rushed it.
Good pressure, good chase there from Rourke Smith, who didn't give up on the contest and forced Hewlett into error.
A golden opportunity gone begging there. And Footscray just allowed that ball over the back on the far side. They cannot allow that to happen.
So Smith with the kicking in duties. Gains 25 metres. Handball over the top to Russell, who could go once again, but decides to go by foot. It probably wasn't the right option, as it turns out. There's a nest of Scorpions there. Hutchins tackled and taken down strongly by Dale, holding the football. Bailey Dale outsized on that occasion. It's not the size of the dog in the fight. As Dale comes away off half-back. Wants to switch, a dangerous one. Sets Toshevsky. Beckwith a task, and he's up to it. Slips past Turlick. Handball to Jamison, who left it behind. Kennedy puts the head down, tries to barge through. Can't do so, and we'll have a bounce.
So a couple of lead changes in the opening term. The Dogs have held this advantage since
1 meter.
Liam Nash's goal at the 19-minute mark of the opening quarter. Oliver will be third man up. Had Kennedy on the outside, denied by Stevens. He can get through traffic. Toshevsky, Beckwith at the back, but can only tumble it as far as Hutchins. Had eyes only for the footy. Newton claimed by Hayes. Hutchins fires off the handball. Oliver amassing a mountain of ball. Puts it in the Smith direction. Denied by his namesake, Rourke. Won't be given it on the second bite. Had hit pause there, Tim Smith. Barry keeps it alive. Kennedy, little kick into a dangerous zone. Wiedemann has to be clean. Fires off a handball. This Bulldogs defence working overtime, but working well. Rourke Smith, he's been the general so far. Off to Russell. Captain of flag 2 years ago and trying to set one up at the moment. Not his best kick though. Webb made good of it. Back to Russell. Not much forward of the footy here. He's forced to bite off a long kick. Dunn will track back to make the contest on Hannon. Good grand final footy. Hutchins comes in for support. He's denied though by Adcock. Newton camps on it. Keeps it alive. Tackled. Dispossessed. Oliver just carves through traffic once again.
He can't be tackled at the moment, Clayton Oliver.
And Trengoval hand off to Neil Bullen.
Kicks towards half forward. Grimes tracks it and marks just inside the line. Toshevsky Beckwith for company. Called to go. Switches. Ambitious bold kick. Lin Jong will cut it off, and maybe now the Dogs can counterpunch. Flips it over the top. Man in space is Jamison. Dalgleish, in fact, on the half volley was an awkward one for Hayes. Nash comes in, lays a tackle. Now it's a foot race to the football. Wiedemann slides in, gets there first, immediately wrapped up. How will the umpire see this one? He'll ball it up.
Well, Dalgleish, streaming through the middle of Etihad Stadium, was pleading for a forward just to come at him. Eventually Hayes did, but fraction late, and the kick was a little bit off, and there went their opportunity.
It's Campbell and Spencer. Trengove. Taken down by Jong. Demonstrated to the umpire that he doesn't have the football.
I think Jong's got very busy to start off this second quarter, so maybe that little skirmish has fired him up a bit.
Hi, Footscray.
Tom Campbell, recipient of the free kick.
Stay out.
Recently re-signed and a new two-year deal with the Dogs. High ball inside 50. Minson at the back of this contest tries to get to the front. Off the hands of Smith, taken by Dunn. High ball outside 50, pitches just inside the line. Turlick versus Campbell. Turlick turns him around nicely. Uses his mobility, gets it to Trengove, who tumbles a kick. And it finds Wiedemann. Wiedemann squares it up to Kennedy in the corridor. He can go over the top. He's got a couple of numbers running forward of the footy. It's picked up by Scott. who can run to 40 metres out, goes the short option and finds Tim Smith.
Well, Jordan Staley was in a really tough position for a defender. It was a 2-on-1 inside 50. Decided to come off his direct opponent, which was Smith, attack the ball carrier, and they chipped the ball over the top and just allowed some overlap run there.
So Tim Smith, some heavy strapping, as you can see, on that left quad after that nasty corky in the opening term. 28 goals, 10 for the season. Centre-half forward in the VFL Team of the Year. And he gives Casey back the lead.
Our forwards, we're getting high. We've got to make early and quick decisions. As soon as we see that ball go to our hands, go, 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 go. All right, the same one as what we've seen with Weeds. All right, really good. Trademark.
Angus Scott tuning into the quarter time huddle from his coach Justin Plapp. He was the man there to set up that Tim Smith goal. Third lead chains. Casey back in front. Stevens, too quick, too agile for McInerney. Puts it inside 50. Hutchins will be the help fist along with Dunn. What have the Dogs got at ground level? John to Long and a third.
Great centre clearance by Kobe Stevens. And three Casey defenders, all experienced defenders, Hutchins, Garland and Dunn flew. It's all well and good to bring that ball to ground and provide aerial support, but they left some dangerous players on the ground and Ben Long was one of them.
Casey with the advantage in the air at that end of the ground, but the Dogs clearly have it on the ground as Turlett goes inside 50 once again. Big pack of players flies, Wiedemann amongst it. Socket forward by Toshevsky Beckworth and he finds the line. So the Dogs' forward line full of small, mobile forwards. They want the footy at ground level. Casey, like it coming in high and long because they've got the advantage in size and height.
There's a really good front and centre there from Ling Jong as well. They've got the handball over to Ben Long.
So the Dogs by 5 points after Casey momentarily snatched back the lead. Minson disposed of the football. Coming the other way was Newton. His handball missed Trengo. Minson tracks it to the line again and happy to take Neil Bullen with a bit of a drive-by. And once again, things get a bit heated on the boundary line as Trengove didn't appreciate the treatment.
Big man just trying to take a bit of body with him across the boundary line there. Just throws a little elbow.
A little bit of collateral damage, will it describe it as Adcock goes towards the wing. Again, front and centre was the Dogs. It was
tackled.
He was hammered into the ground by Newton. The ball's with Neil Bullen. Webb slow to get up behind the play. Inside 50, chance for Casey. Quick hands from Smith. Wiedemann's handball was partly smothered. It falls to Kennedy. Tries to fashion it across his body to Hewlett. Now Wiedemann, now Smith. Confronted, taken down. Doggies defence arrived just in time. Rourke Smith to Staley. Awkward one for Honeychurch. And Oliver slaps it over the line.
A really physical game. Have a look at this for a tackle. Just got absolutely nailed. Fairly, but he made him earn it. Wouldn't refuse to get off him as well, Ben Newton. Lucas Webb feeling the effects of that.
Wiedemann and Minson taken by Smith off the ruck contest. Can he bend it back? Oh, that's a magnificent finish. What a goal.
Goal almost out of nowhere there. Smith just from the stoppage throws it on the boot and it's gone straight through. So he's kicked the last two. And having a real influence now on this contest.
Play centre-half forward, but at 192, so he's effective on the ground as well.
Inspirational. Now 30 goals for the season. Garland to rebound. Can Casey try and stretch this elastic band on the Bulldogs midpoint of this second quarter? Russell will deny them once again and let fly down the line. Long, Dunn, Hannon, third man in. It favours Dunn. He's nailed by Long. Good tackle. It might turn it over as well. Hannon wanted to flip it to Hayes. Denied by Garland, and Casey will try and set up once again. Correll, but eventually Grimes the man on the outside. Great pressure from Honeychurch. Sort of stuff that turns grand finals. Long, clipped by Oliver, and off go the Scorpions again with this tumble kick we see time and time again. Smith having an electric turn, looking for a third, perhaps being held. It spills free. Oh, Nash just poked it through traffic. Finds Rourke Smith, and he continues to set them up from the back. Greenwood, forward for Lynch. Lowers the vision. Well played for Hannon. Eyes darting, blue jumpers everywhere inside 50. Hayes, the man in the corridor.
Well, the decision by Lynch not to blaze away to the top of the square and just lower his eyes created this 450 mark to Hayes. He's been quiet so far this afternoon, but that was a really important kick there. And then Hannon can pull back off the mark
and find the follow-up secondary mark inside 50.
Lynch and Russell with 11 possessions each. The Dogs leading ball getters so far, setting them up from the back once again. One of the six Dogs to play in that 2014 premiership in the VFL, Will Hayes. A stuttering season for him after some injuries, and it continues with a behind here.
So once again, the Dogs wasting opportunities. 3-8 to 4-2, 11 shots to 6, and scores are level.
And two very gettable goals. The Ling Chong poster right on quarter time, and that one to Hayes. They're not going to get any easier than that in grand finals.
Lyndon Dunn goes to Jones. Good effort from Nash to get across and at least force a spillage. But Jones tidied it up to White, and now Oliver at defensive 50. Clayton Oliver, 14th possession coming up. Switches to the opposite pocket and finds his skipper Hutchins. Hutchins moves it along to Garland. He goes short and finds Mitchie. Next link in the chain is Kielty. Precise movement from Casey, but with some speed to it. Penetrating the Bulldog zone. Scott to Grimes from 55, and that's the kick that lets them down. Staley cuts it off.
That's the important kick, but you can see Casey really trying to use the whole width of this Etihad Stadium.
So now Staley looks to switch and do likewise, but John can't get it and go because Turlick was standing the mark. So he'll have to hold it up, wait for an option to present. Kick to space really on the wing. Smith the only one to attack it with Doc Leash for company, and it spills out. There's Joel Smith, the son of a high-flying Sean Smith. He played 109 games for North Melbourne and Melbourne between 1987 and 1998. Took one of the great marks of all time at the Gabba. Campbell, beautiful tap down to John. Good quick hands to the first receiver, Greenwood. Now to Adcock, who's got to be quick. Ferreira gets him. Alessio Ferreira, the exciting 20-year-old from Wonthaggi, the 23rd man this afternoon. He goes to the City wing and finds Matt Jones. Again, happy to just chip it around and retain possession. This is Oliver.
Yeah, they're happy to be nice and patient.
They got burned on the counter-attack a few times in the first term. Hey. Newton over the top to Neil Bullen.
And as a defender, if you're a Footscray defender, you wouldn't be too unhappy with that either. Slow movement into the pocket, even that one. It's not ideal that you're getting marks, conceding marks inside 50, but if you have to concede them, as far wide as you possibly can.
Tough angle for Turlick out there. He's kicked 18-19 for the season.
If Dean Turley can kick this, well, then you say good luck to you.
15 gone.
Looked around, assessed his options, decides he'll go for it. Runs around, hits the wrong side of the football. Still in a dangerous position for Casey. Is there a mark? There is. And it's that man, Tim Smith.
Well, that's inexcusable to concede a mark.
Chance to kick his third for the quarter.
He's just turned this game on its head, Tim Smith. He almost looked gone in that second quarter. We know how tough he is. They call him the Bull, and he doesn't often show much pain, let alone come off. But he was in genuine pain there from that corky, and he's come back on with his leg taped. He's lining up for his third in the quarter.
His contested marking is elite. Unfortunately, he's finishing on that occasion not so. He's kicked two goals, one. Casey now frittering a couple of opportunities. They probably should have converted. They lead by a point. 16 and a half minutes gone. Second term of the VFL Grand Final.
Jordan Russell trying to get it deep into the centre of the ground. Kielty with the fist. Hamilton denied by Webb, who's kicked from the back of the square. Will hang. Garland with eyes for the footy. Hannon got hands to it. The dangerous long tries to sweep onto it. Sensing the danger was Newton. He just wanted to find body first, then ball. Dogs will get the free kick. The man camped on at the end was Kielty, so opportunity for the Bulldogs to try and take back this lead as we tick beyond the midpoint of this second term. No closer to learning what's going to take out the 2016 Peter Jackson VFL Premiership. Ben Long with a goal already in this quarter, and now a chance for the Dogs to try and gather some momentum. Toshevsky Beckwith executes the kick before Turlick on the scene. Nice grabbing flight from Smith. Channeling some of Dad Sean's athleticism and aerial ability. A lot of fun watching him, D's fans, in years to come. Long kick, Staley in good position. Drop what he perhaps should have taken. Can Casey take advantage? Grimes, Toshevsky, Beckwith, Newton. Strong work from Stevens. And another stoppage.
And Brownie, that last kick inside 50 to a pack situation. It might work for Casey. They've got the tall forwards. It's not going to work for the Dogs too often.
Now, the Doggies have really struggled to take a contested mark inside their forward 50. They need to do it just with good ball movement, lowering their eyes.
Stevens emerges, sends it in the Hannon direction. It got to the back. The fist wasn't effective enough from Garland. He needs to deny Hayes. And he will momentarily.
Once it hits the deck, they look so dangerous, don't they?
Well, they've got Long, they've got Hayes, they've got the athletic Hannon all down there. Bailey Dale as well. So they really just need to get the ball to ground at any cost.
Five lead changes so far. Minson and just fell into his lap out of the ruck. Munro gathered, wanted Oliver, couldn't find him. Neil Bullen stripped in the tackle and he gets up proppy as well. Players going down left, right and centre. Webb flicks it out. Garland just thumps the kick clear. Toshevsky back with setup. Smith on the scene. Splits the pack for Grimes and Kenny can now be away from the Scorpions.
Chance for the Scorps through Ferreira, but runs into traffic. Straight into Bailey Williams, who takes him down. He's got some support. It's Mitchie. Now to Munro. Grits the teeth. Tries to get past Smith, but can't do so. And in the process, turns it over.
Great tackle by Rourke Smith. Just forced that turnover.
Jamison to Staley, and now Nash in the middle of the ground. He's got Jong out at left half forward. And hits him with the kick. Jong wants a short option inside 50. No one leading towards him, as you can see. The space is there. So in the end, he'll decide to pop it up. White in best position, dispossessed. Minson tries to muscle his way through the white tackle. Can't do so. Eventually, it spits out to Kilty. Quick kick to the defensive 50. Mitchie tries to keep it going. And Spencer and Adcock see it out. Game in a little bit of a stalemate in this second term as we end a time on or approach it. It's Casey by a point.
It's really delicately poised, isn't it? Both sides setting plenty of numbers back into their defence. Goals have been very hard to come by.
Spencer and Minson. Minson got the fist. Mitchie immediately tackled by John. Got the hands freed of Neil Bullen, who did likewise to Grimes. Grimes across his body off the hands of Hewlett. It's a 3-on-1 at the back for the Dogs. Barry. Ferreira tries to strip him of the football, does well. Handball missed Hewlett, but got time to go back and fetch it. Kick was partly smothered. Trying to bust through hard was Munro. Adcock went just as hard in the other direction. And the non-officiating umpire has spotted a high one.
Just a good, strong contest there. All plays.
Just the left arm of Adcock slipping high. Kennedy. Inside 50, Wiedemann sets himself and takes it on his chest. Sam Wiedemann, taken at pick 9 in last year's draft after having stress fractures in his ankle last year. Just 5 TAC games. Such a reliable kick this season. He's kicked 24 goals, 5 at VFL level. And 3 goals straight at AFL level. So 24 goals, 5 for the season in the VFL. And he can make it 25. Beautiful finish from Sam Wiedemann. Sam Wiedemann averaging 10 touches a game, but when you kick 28 goals, 5 for a season, you don't need many opportunities.
He certainly makes them pay when he gets. It was really quiet last week in the preliminary final, just the 3 disposals, but started today beautifully. 9 touches and 2 goals.
Biggest lead of the day. That's saying something about the contest for the Scorpions. 7 points their advantage, 3 goals to 1 in the term. Webb tumbles the kick forward. It beats Dunn. Won't beat Hutchins, at least on the first bite anyway. He's claimed by Hayes. Honeychurch. Happy to let it come out. Garland will camp on him and the ruck and maul finishes with Minson.
Right up.
Will Minson shouldering most of the ruck work so far for the Bulldogs. Tom Campbell spending a bit more time forward. Minson with 14 hitouts of the Dogs, 22 so far. Keelty will flip it to Neil Bullen. Munro. And the exit will be through Turlick, who did really well to sense the day. Get through the traffic, execute the kick down the line. Hewlett taken high. Advantage paid. Turlick follows up his kick. And we'll have a hard time getting it out of the clinches of Andrew Toshevsky Beckwith.
Let's go. Straight up.
And Turlick's, of course, suspended in the qualifying final.
It's the only game he missed for the year.
2 goals in that match. Knows the thing about playing in grand finals. Won a premiership with Norwood in the Sandful. In between his time with Sydney and Melbourne, Neil Bullen wanted to find Big Spencer. Ball just camps on top of him and Campbell will add to the pile.
So 23 minutes gone, second term of the VFL Grand Final. It's the Scorpions by 7 points. Game delicately balanced. Nice tap from Spence, but it was taken by Dale. Might have copped a high shot. Jong feeds a handball wide. They've got some runners. Adcock can release Lynch. How's the finish from 40 metres out? Bends it across his body, and that's a classy finish from Brad Lynch.
Brilliant.
So Brad Lynch, the 19-year-old from Mandurah, south of Perth and Swan Districts, playing Colts footy last year in the Waffle, onto the rookie list for the Dogs this year, and that was a great finish.
Yeah, he's got elite speed, great kick, and again, it was Ling Jong in congestion, just bringing one of his teammates, the half-backer, into it in Lynch.
Stevens to Jong, who's taken in a quick tackle. Mitchie comes through in the other direction. Here's Lynch again. Ferreira's got a piece of him. Stripped of the football. Kennedy goes hunting at ground level. Can he get it? No, he can't. Trent Gove and Adcock with a piece of it as well.
They're the half chances, though. Goals like that against the Tide, it could go either way. That could be the difference in a really tight grand final.
Margins hits as it did at the end of their clash in round 15 on that day. The Dogs reign supreme. Minson push Kielty out of the contest. Hannon taken a ground by Dunn, who's had plenty of work to do so far. A couple of veteran Ds in defence today for Casey. Dunn and Garland. Mitchie forward for Kennedy, who's warmed into the contest in this second term. Oliver's been prominent. Go down the line. Wiedemann got hands to it. Smith at the fall, having a big quarter. Stripped of it. Barry once, twice, denied by Hewlett. Will thump the kick forward. Ferreira's out the back. Will it get there in time? Great pressure from Dale. It's even better to get the fist on it, then the intercept mark, and give the Dogs back possession. They'll load the gun. Jamison, Hamilton off the line. Thought he had Dalgleish, who was kept there. On the scene, the Ds in this Casey team working in tandem, and Newton can hit up Garland for a rare shot on goal.
He does have the journey. He's got a booming kick, but a great bit of work there from Bailey Dale. He was out of position. Ferreira looked like he was in the box seat for all money. He just found a way to get back, create a contest and take that mark. And we haven't seen too many players miss targets coming out of their back half today, but on that occasion, Casey could make the Doggies hurt.
Run-up Michael Holding would be proud of here from Cole Garland, who's kicked just one goal in his 17 VFL games this season. Contact okay, it'll miss right. Flies will come, and the man deepest was Hewlett. Had no right to get hands on that.
Well, that's two marks now that the Footscray defenders have conceded in a packed situation, which they'd be really disappointed about.
We knew without Robinson Hamling they would be undersized down back. At the moment, it's working to Casey's advantage to just bomb it into big packs. Hewlett, Wiedemann and Smith all been effective.
Two behind so far for Liam Hewlett. Chance for a major. And puts the Scorpions back out by 7 points. That three-prong attack inside forward 50 for the Scorpions starting to really get busy. 5 goals now between Wiedemann, Smith and Hewlett.
And that'd excite Melbourne fans. Hewlett picked 46 in last year's draft. He's played 18 VFL games and kicked 29 goals. That's a terrific return.
Four of those goals coming in the second term. Jong met Sondland in the other direction by Kennedy. Minson, little give to Lynch. Goes to Dalgleish, who runs to 55. Takes on the man with speed. 48 metres out. Goes for goal, but can't quite work it back. Lockie Dalgleish, who won the Terang gift back in 2011, just 3 days after missing the AFL draft. So he has got speed to burn. As Dunn goes short to Munro. Now Trent Gove. It's back to a goal of difference as we tick over 28 minutes in the second term of the VFL Grand Final. Trent Gove high towards the wing. Big pack again. It spills to Minson at the back. He couldn't quite hang on. Smith not busting through there. We'll have a ball up.
Now, thank you.
Okay.
Plenty of players around this contest. Newton, Oliver, Turlick, Kennedy gets boot to ball quickly. Smith comes out, attacks the football, couldn't quite take the mark. At ground level, the Dogs now scrapping off the back foot. Hamilton, he's taken down in a strong tackle by Tim Smith and gone.
I spoke about Tim Smith's tackling ability and physicality in the pre-game. We're seeing it on display today.
Smith, high ball inside 50. There's Russell at his best. Third man up, picked it off. And now a chance for the Dogs to launch if they can switch quickly. Stevens spots Dalgleish. It was beautifully read and picked off by Newton. So Newton, 55 from home, wheels onto his left boot, gives it a ride, gives it plenty. Has it got the journey? Not quite. Once again, it's Jordan Russell saving the day for the Dogs.
Well, Lyndon Dunn is the spare down one end for Casey, and it looks like Jordan Russell is the spare for Footscray as we're deep into this second quarter.
Tumbling kick from Russell, favoured Jong. He'll like his chances to dash away from McInerney. Two bounces. The final act of a pulsating opening half. Casey, 4-2 to 2-2 in the quarter.
They're going
at him again. The sequel won't be better than the original as Lin Jong once again has the collarbone tested out, not dissimilar to what happened at quarter time.
Is it part of the game plan at the end of the quarter? Someone go to Lin and rough him up.
Everything they keep throwing at him, he just keeps bouncing to his feet.
So Casey with 4 goals, 2 in that second term. The Dogs with 2 goals, 2. And at halftime in the 2016 VFL Grand Final, as Will Minson provides some ongoing advice. It's Casey 6-3-39, Footscray 4-9-33. Will Minson into Oscar McInerney, the youngster. There's Adcock and Trengove, two veterans. Much more sophisticated the way they go about sorting out their differences. And at halftime, there's plenty of spirit. The game is in the balance. It's the Scorps by 6 points at the major break.
Halftime break brought to you by Toyota.
Kick off your grand final weekend with an encore screening of The Final Draw, a powerful tale that delves deep into the emotions of footy's last drawn grand final from 2010. Then join Mick and the team for a special grand final eve, Friday Front Bar, looking back at the season past and previewing the big match ahead. Then put on your PJs as the grand final marathon keeps you company all night with a look back at some of the greatest grand finals in history. Grand Final Eve on 7, mate. It's the perfect way to kick off your footy weekend.
It's half time of the VFL Grand Final. It was Footscray by 6 points at the first change. Casey adding 4 goals, 2 to 2 goals, 2 in the second term to take that 6-point deficit and turn it into a 6-point lead at the major break. The Scorpions, the minor premiers, up by one straight kick at half time in what's been a spirited contest. Their forwards, their big forwards, really getting on top in that second term. They've kicked 5 of their 6 goals, Hewlett, Wiedemann and Smith. And at the major break, it's Casey 6-3-39 leading Footscray 4-9-33. As we take a look at some of the numbers, Footscray with the inside 50 dominance, 27-19. But Casey, a little bit more accurate, their 9 scoring shots compared to 13. Yet they lead by a goal. Clayton Oliver with 17 possessions, outstanding in that first half. Well, the grand final marathon's coming up on 7. So much to look forward to. One bloke who I don't think will be watching the marathon, although you might be awake and thinking about it, is Jason Johannesson, who joins us from the Western Bulldogs. Firstly, congratulations on the roller coaster ride so far, and what a week ahead.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for having me. And yeah, it's just really exciting at the minute, and it's a good buzz around the club.
We were speaking of the game last night, GWS and the Western Bulldogs. The Doggies got home in the end by 6 points. Brownie described it as one of the best games of footy he's ever seen. What was it like to play in?
Yeah, it was very intense. You know, I'd put it up to one of the games. It was the hardest I've ever played. So, no, it was just great to get the win in the end.
How the boys get through, obviously, Jordan Roughhead's eye is a little bit of a concern, but you're probably in the enviable position where Ling Jong's playing today. He's playing really well. Suckling is a chance to come back in. There's plenty of guys that are putting their hands up at the right time.
Yeah, no, Ruffy's pulled up really well. We're very optimistic that he'll play, and obviously Suckers is just missed last week, but he looks good to go.
Outside the group, we're all caught up in the romance of the story, the underdog, the fairy tale. Inside the group, are we selling you a bit short? Is it just a really good football team executing your game plan?
Oh, I don't know. We just go out there, try and play to our system, and we believe that we can beat anyone, and that's just what we're going to do.
The vibe around the club, obviously, with the fans, both last night and then here today, you're in a VFL Grand Final. You've got guys like Peter Gordon, who's been there in 1989 when the club almost went out of business. You've got Robert Murphy and players on the periphery who can't directly be part of it. It must be an incredibly special time and a very tight group.
Yeah, definitely. And to the fans that made the extra trip to come see us play, because it's been such a long time coming, it's made it extra special.
What was Bevo's message after the game?
I just said that, like everyone else is going to tell you, is just enjoy the week and just soak it up.
Well, enjoy the week and soak it up.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations once again. Good luck for the week ahead. We're really looking forward to the ride.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Jason Johannesson from the Western Bulldogs. The Footscray VFL side, they've still got a bit of work to do. One half of football stands between them and the VFL Premiership. It's the Casey Scorpions by 6 points at halftime in the 2016 VFL Grand Final. Back with more from Etihad Stadium right after this. Welcome back to Etihad Stadium, halftime in the VFL Grand Final. It's the Casey Scorpions 6-3-39, leading Footscray 4-9-33. The Scorps with 4-2 in that second term to come from a goal down at quarter time to lead by a kick at the major break. Jason Bennett alongside Nigel Carman as we welcome you into an Etihad Stadium. And Nudge, what have you made of the first half?
I think the Bulldogs will rue some of those missed chances in the opening term. 9 scoring shots in the opening quarter. Casey have had 9 scoring shots themselves, but have made so much more of their chances. And I think the marking inside 50 is starting to become significant. We mentioned in the call, Hewlett, Wiedemann and Smith now with 5 of those 6 goals between them. And the major source of those has been marks. The Bulldogs don't have that forward of the play, and they need obviously to defend it in the Casey forward half as well.
Yeah, the game's pretty much panned out as we predicted pre-game, hasn't it, really? The one X factor that's still to be determined is who wins that midfield battle, and that's ultimately probably going to decide the game.
And it's been a really close contest so far, and credit to both midfields. They've cracked in, but been pretty clean at times on the outside as well. But some of the contested ball stuff that we've seen, particularly from Clayton Oliver, 17 possessions to halftime. He's been phenomenal, how he's carved through traffic on a couple of occasions and created play for the Scorpions.
Yeah, it's been ferocious on the inside and exciting when one side gets it to the outside. Let's take you down into both rooms now. We'll start with the Casey Scorpions and head down to Nick Carnell. Nick, what's the vibe like at halftime?
Yeah, really calm and composed group down here at the moment, Jay. It's a really healthy contingent of Melbourne coaching staff too. They spoke to the players as they're in the background behind me. The forwards spoke about just nullifying the impact of Jordan Russell. They're aware that obviously he's having a fair impact for the Bulldogs at the moment. And I spoke to the doctors really quickly. No injuries at the moment, so a full healthy list for the Casey Scorpions.
Thanks, Nick. Let's take you across to the Footscray rooms now. Abby Holmes is in the Footscray room. She's been listening to Coach Ash Hansen. Abs, what have you learnt?
I am, Jason. The players are in their team meeting as we speak, but there's a great feeling of determination down here. Luke Beveridge and other senior Western Bulldogs players are in attendance, which will no doubt be providing some inspiration from their phenomenal preliminary final win last night. But Ash Hansen, quite content with that first half of football. They're running the corridors well. They're getting that quick, swift ball movement, which is where we're seeing their best passages of play. But interestingly, Footscray have only won 7 out of 21 third quarters for the season. So that's definitely a stat that they're going to want to be on top of.
Thanks, Ab. Still a half of football to come. We still believe that the midfield battle is ultimately going to be the deciding factor in this one. Casey had 20 more uncontested possessions on the outside in that first half, but those numbers can be a little bit deceptive. I think the Bulldogs would be reasonably happy with how much of that first half they had on their own terms. Casey kind of got their noses in front late in the second.
Yeah, well, 3 of the last 4 goals, the significant thing attached to those uncontested possessions is the marks. They had 25-12 in the quarter, Casey, so they started to get the ball they wanted on the outside, and we've mentioned it all day, if they get enough supply, we think they win the game, and the Bulldogs had done well enough to go head-to-head with them in the inside 50 count, but you just felt like the game turned a little bit towards the end of the quarter. That said, at the moment it's just all about the Bulldogs and whether they can capitalise on their opportunities.
Any obvious tweaks you'd be making as a coach of either team?
Jordan Russell's still the one for me that I don't think Casey have properly addressed. He's been able to freewheel and do as he's liked, and that also has then worked well in tandem with Brad Lynch, which we've seen throughout the final series. It's probably the one that Justin Platt might hone in on, but with the game and the lead in their hands at the moment, perhaps they're prepared to continue to roll the dice, particularly while, as we've said, their key forwards are doing so much damage.
Half of football still to come in the VFL Grand Final. The first half was exciting. It was physical. It was aggressive at times, and there was some exciting finishing going on from both teams as well. And as the Casey Scorpions head out for the third term, they lead by 6 points. We'll take a break and be back with all the third quarter action from the 2016 VFL Grand Final right after this. Both sides back out on the ground. The second half of the VFL Grand Final. There's Lin Zhong with the left shoulder strapped up. Now, Super Sleuth Campbell Brown's been looking at the photos from the preliminary of the qualifying final, or the elimination final. Lin Zhong had the right shoulder strapped.
Yeah, he broke his right collarbone, but he's had a bit of trouble with his left shoulder, so he always straps that. So it's not just to trick the Casey boys into thinking that it's the left collarbone.
They've just gone at whatever collarbone they could get their hands on in the first half. He's been a real target, Lin Zhong, but what a first half of football he's played. He's been absolutely outstanding, leading the way for Footscray in that opening half of football. Stepped straight back in after a couple of weeks off and had 15 possessions. Oliver's had 17, Kennedy and Grimes 16 for Casey.
And the important thing about Ling Zhong's possessions are they've created goals from him. He handballed over the top to the long goal. He gave it the ball to Lynch, who went on and kicked the goal. His vision in tight's been really good, but massive half here for both midfields, because that's where the game is going to be won. It's been pretty defensively minded on both sides in the first half, but if you can win those clearances, if you can win those contested hard balls and play the game on your terms inside 50, you're going to give yourself every chance of victory today.
Third quarter of the 2016 VFL Grand Final. Jason Bennett alongside Campbell Brown, Abby Holmes, Nick Carnell, and here's Nigel Carmody to get us underway in the third.
So the dream week for the Bulldogs, or a 17-year drought ends for the Casey Scorpions. Two quarters of footy to find out. Just joining us, 4-2 second quarter. So the Scorpions flip what was a 6-point deficit at quarter time into a 1-goal advantage at the long break. Second time round, Spencer the hit out. Oliver, an 18th possession. Jones met solidly and off the wing goes Dale. Lightning. Can steady. Go deep. Campbell trying to take Dunn to task. Funny bouncing ball. Can Campbell fashion a goal? He can't. Dunn, once again, just does well to halve contest after contest. Luke Beveridge. Lucas Bontempelli, Easton Wood, Stephen King and Rob Murphy just tugging into something from
you can
the
do that
ball
when you,
at half time.
You can do that when you're not playing. You can jump in the 4 and 20 pots.
Mitchie just went the two-footed jump. Come to ground level for Oliver, who just says, come at me. Misses the handball though. Webb on his favourite side. Kick was touched, as you can hear. Mitch White, the deepest man, put the hands up, hoping for it to bounce in there, and Campbell just dumps him over the line.
That's a really good result there for Footscray. There's a 2v1. Tom Campbell, just that defensive work, just getting it over the boundary line for a defensive stoppage. So,
not fruit, a pie. Wrong part of the food pyramid.
Yeah, I was going to say, what part of fruit was that?
Ball back into play. Grimes, quick kick. Outside, defensive 50. Turlick with a couple to beat. And in the end of the boundary line, not a bad result.
This is what Footscray did so well in the first quarter. They were able to lock the ball inside their forward half and get repeat inside 50 entries. Now, they didn't convert them into goals. They need to do it a little bit better here in this third term.
Vincent at the front tried to slap it over the back. Adcock grabbed it, but Spencer grabbed him and dumped him. We're not in possession. Free kick to Jed Adcock. So the Dogs making the early running in this third term. He delivers short to Lin Zhong. 16th possession coming up for Lin. Bombed him deep. Campbell's his target. Once again, a couple of Casey defenders to beat. Dunn and White, and they get it to the line.
Again, they're just playing into Casey's hands with those slow, high inside 50 entries. Love to see him just change it up. Maybe switch the ball around the arc, try and open up some free space on the far side.
Minson at the front again, tries to slap it away from the congestion, but Garland gets on the end of it. High ball will pitch inside 50. Russell fisted away. Here's Zhong again, squares it up. Here's Williams, 55 metres from home, steps inside the man, runs to 45, pins the ears back and puts it through. So just the second goal of Bailey Williams' 9-game VFL career, but what a beauty.
Magnificent. He's had a great first year as well. Tasted AFL footy. Ling Zhong involved again, and he just backed himself in, sold some candy and buried it, and they're now in front, Footscray.
A sixth lead change in an arm wrestle. Zhong getting busy to start this third quarter. Stevens will come to run and support Honeychurch, who favours the bounce. They combine now. Stevens had men in board, goes further afield. Hamilton tried to take on Dunn, just wants to gain ground by hand. Trengove comes to meet that ball, and Jed Adcock, searching for a farewell flag, sees him over the line.
Really good bit of play by Lyndon Dunn, just to identify the situation, come off his direct opponent and force a tackle there. But again, Footscray just winning the territory battle, locking this ball inside their forward 50.
At 7 VFL on Twitter or Facebook if you want to get involved in the conversation. It's Grimes at the back. Miscues. He's been
forced just a blast kick a couple of times out of defensive 50, and it's already hurt them once in this quarter. Honeychurch had the presence of mind to slip in and receive the Dalglish kick. And once again, they won't want to bomb this ball. Just
this is where they need to think it through a little bit. And really smart bit of play there.
Minson and Campbell have both pushed forward. Williams got the go-ahead goal. He'll go in the Campbell direction. Finally got some separation on Spencer.
Well, they just changed the angles a little bit there. By Honeychurch bringing the ball back into the middle of the ground, all of a sudden as a defender, you're playing on your forward and they can go either way. So you can't push them to one side, which you prefer to do. And Tom Campbell, who has been allowed no time and space at all inside their forward 50, just got some separation on Spencer and took a big mark. This is a huge kick.
7-5 this BFL season. Goals in the semi and the prelim, and now in the big dance.
So the first five inside 50s of the term going to Footscray, and importantly, they're putting it on the scoreboard. They kicked two goals, one.
Yeah, converted into two important goals, and Tom Campbell, he played in the 2014 Premiership. That goal really helps him.
Oliver tracks it at ground level. He's run down hard from behind by Adcock. Forces the turnover. Campbell to Greenwood. Footscray trying to take control. Mitchie, quick kick inside 50. Smith stands underneath it. Couldn't quite bring it down. At ground level, Russell wraps up Wiedemann.
They've just come out with more intent in this second half at the moment, Footscray. The tackling pressure, they're winning the contested ball.
Got themselves out to a 7-point lead. Neil Bullen at ground level couldn't take it. Nash feeds it to Honeychurch, who throws it on the boot, bouncing ball to the wing. 2-on-1 for the Dogs. Nice gather from Hannon. Wants to take Dunn on. High kick, long with speed, tracking back to this goal square with Newton. Long still alive. Newton did well in the end. He closed down the angles and slapped it through.
Oh, how exciting is that? Hannon, who's got some leg speed, a bit of X-factor, kicking long into some space, and Newton did really well there because Ben Long is quick and he was goal side.
So Hutchins with the football. Goes towards Spencer. Campbell in there as well. Ricochets forward of the contest. Oliver couldn't take it cleanly. Spencer stripped of it. Greenwood goes hard against Grimes at ground level. The former Melbourne skipper tries to win it, but he's wrapped up and we'll have another stoppage.
They're just hunting in numbers at the moment. Casey don't have an answer for it. The first 7 minutes of this third term have all been Footscray.
Pensive Justin Plapp, who's side led by 6 points at half time, now trailing by 8. 2-2 to nothing in the quarter for the Dogs. Toshevsky back with Webb, Hayes back to Toshevsky, back with kick into the corridor, wants Hannon. Dunn comes to meet it. Hannon denies him and can release Williams. Already got one in the quarter. Time to steady. Couldn't finish it off on the left.
Big opportunity gone begging there. Again, it was Mitch Hannon though, just getting involved, winning that ground ball. Dishing it out to Williams.
The centering kick was the right idea. It just wasn't quite executed properly. They had a 3-on-1 opportunity. Mitch White, Casey a little bit rattled early in this third term. Off the hands of Honeychurch and out of bounds. So what can the Scorpions do now to try and stabilise the contest?
They need to get their hands on the ball at the moment. Every time they've come out of their defensive 50, it's been with a rush, hack kick, as long as they can. Footscray's defensive press has just been picking them off. Just need a little bit of composed possession at the moment.
Spencer pushes Campbell under the football. Oliver once again wins it. Gives it to Kennedy. Punches a kick towards Wiedemann. Couple to beat. Ground level. The Dogs have the numbers. Dalglish spears a little pass to Bailey Williams, who's been influential in this third term. The switch is on. The Dogs now getting some run to the outside. This is Greenwood. He's held up. Steps around Smith. Bold kick inside fifth in the centre, rather, is picked off by Newton. Trengove to Smith. They've got numbers forward of the football if they can win it. Jones does, but he goes laterally and sets it up to Hutchins. Hutchins across his body to Hewlett at 50, and he marks. Hewlett wants to bring it inboard to Oliver. He's got it just inside 50.
You've got to be so careful if you're bringing that ball through the corridor that you do not turn it over like Greenwood just did there. He had some men queuing up on the far side to continue the switch of play, which was probably the better option in the end, but they play a bold brand of football, Footscray.
So Clayton Oliver has been outstanding in this game so far. It's his 21st possession. Chance to hit the scoreboard. For a steadying goal for Casey from 55 out. He gives it everything. It's going to drop short. Campbell in best position. Glances off his fist and out for a throw-in.
Good work by the big man. taking marks up one end and kicking goals. He worked hard to get down on the last line there, create a contest. Tom Campbell.
Just Casey's second inside 50 of the quarter so far. McInerney back onto the ground. Smith was third man up. Oh, Munro dealt with solidly and it'll turn it over. Honeychurch, Stevens, oh, just evaded Smith to the hushes of the crowd. Keelty, Trengove, Jones through traffic, been busy for the Scorpions. Can they find a mark forward of the ball? McInerney just outbodied by the bigger Campbell, bigger by weight, not by centimetres.
There's just experience again. He's been really influential in this third term. Liam Nash with some heavy work as well, just setting the tone physically.
Stevens, kick smothered. Dog still with work to do. Honeychurch, he won't get free. Tim Smith and Matt Jones working in tandem. Mitch Honeychurch, 12 possessions so far. Just slightly below par for what's been a pulsating season for him in the best 14 times in the Dogs VFL team.
Averaging 27 a game.
Jones, another possession. Honeychurch, the aforementioned, with the smother, and it's out of bounds on the full after ricocheting. So Dogs will once again get control of the footy, and it's been their third term so far, edging out to a 9-point margin.
So Kobe Stevens has it in the back pocket. Pick it high down the line. Again, Campbell the target. McInerney forced to fly from behind, got the fist down to Oliver. Oliver to Kennedy. Looks inside 50. Trengove has to stop and wait. That was the target. But the kick just hung long enough for Dalgleish to get across and pick it off. He goes short to Russell. Again, the Dogs prepared to be bold with their ball usage off half-back. Russell to Lynch. They do have great users in the back half of the ground who like to set up play with short, patient build-ups like this one. This is Nash. Try to manipulate it into an area where they can attack from, and then they go full throttle from there.
And this is where Casey just need to work really hard to force them to kick long down the line.
Greenwood gets a shepherd and then does just that. Kicks long down the line, but it's all Casey back there. It wasn't the right option, and Kilty picks it off.
That's because they didn't have anyone to kick the ball short to on that occasion. They worked hard to man up Casey then.
Munro tries to get some run going with Newton. The 1-2 back to Jimmy Munro. Now he attacks the corridor. Matt Jones has got to go. Well played by Honeychurch. Forced it to ground. Now it opens up for Lin Jong. He's away. Ben Long, the only man inside 50. If it sits, he's gone. Has a bounce. Runs to 20 and kicks the goal.
It was a dangerous kick inboard there from Casey. Great bit of work from Honeychurch here, just forcing a contest. And surprise, surprise, Ling Jong is the man that gets on the end of it. And they got away with one early in the quarter, Casey, letting Ben Long goal side, not on that occasion.
Just eight inside 50s for the term. They've kicked 3-3. Their conversion really improving.
Dominating.
They'll go again. Webb, Stevens, Hayes on the outside. Can't get full purchase on the kick. It won't matter. Toshevsky Beckwith. Markle free kick. Hutchins late on the scene. And the 50 is paid. And the Dogs will get a shot at a fourth goal for the term. And Jack Hutchins, after being the man to impact the 50, this is down.
This is a genuine melee here. And it's been bubbling away. He was sitting under the high ball. I didn't think that Jack Hutchins, the kick skipper of Casey, did anything wrong except try and force a contest. They've kicked the goal. And this could be a defining moment in this grand final. Footscray dominating.
So Andrew Toshevsky Beckwith kicks the goal. Jack Hutchins trying to regain his faculties. And his team is under siege. Four unanswered goals in this quarter of the Dogs. Andrew Toshevsky Beckwith with his first. Ben Long, the only multiple goal kicker so far for the Dogs. We see Hutchins was late, just a split second late, and then gets clipped on the way through by Ben Long.
Long's just got him an absolute beauty. Just winded him in the bread basket. And Lyndon Dunn comes over the top. No Casey player stood the mark. And all of a sudden, Footscray have just blown this game apart with 15 minutes of absolute dominance to start off this second half.
They're converting the inside 50s into goals, and away they go again. Dogs on top here. Minton, another beautiful tap. Inside 50. Hutchins forced to spoil. Kilty at the back, got a couple to beat. Toshevsky Beckwith comes in to lay some pressure. Can he win the football? Kilty scrapping at ground level. White arrives as well. And the minor premiers are on the rack right now.
It's been all Footscray. The last 10 scores, Footscray's way. They're winning the clearances.
Minton
Through the hands of Stevens is Jong again, who's been outstanding. Mitchie ushers him over the line.
Well, he's almost been the most influential man on the ground, Lin Jong.
19 possessions. Lin Jong
putting his hand up for an AFL call-up with a performance like this today.
It's been tough in tight and creative out wide. McInerney couldn't quite get a fist to it. Stevens at the back tries to steamroll through. Got the hands free to Hamilton. Ineffective handball. Pressure on Jones. Feeds it back to Hutchins. Can the Scorps get something going? This is Russell versus Scott, and Russell wins it.
Just protected the where the ball was going to drop so well then, Russell.
Lin Jong stands and waits. He marks at 55. Again, the switch is on. Smith tracks it back, but he won't get there in time. Jamison marks, and once again, they use the space laterally superbly.
Two things that they've dominated this quarter, the clearance work, especially the centre bounces, and they've just started to change the angles up a little bit with their forward 50 entries, and it's made it much harder for Casey defenders that love zoning off, love the aerial contest. Forced them to defend, and they haven't been able to in this third quarter.
Well, they dominated the inside 50s in the first half, but the difference in this third term is they're getting high percentage shots at goal. That wasn't one of them. And Jamison accordingly puts it out of bounds on the full. But in the first half, you mentioned that they were... No sauce on your pie, Bob? That's from Daisy Pierce. Oh, that's an Australian, Bob.
I don't know anyone that doesn't have sauce on their pie.
No wonder Nudge thought it was a Granny Smith apple.
Extraordinary stuff there by the skipper.
You said in the first half their entries were shallow. They weren't in dangerous positions to kick goals. With the exception of that Jamison entry, it's been very different in this third term.
Even though the Jamison missed his target, it forced them out of bounds on the floor. It forced them to be nice and deep and defend.
It's all working for the Dogs at the moment. Jamison will load up. Kick not quite to the advantage of Hannon. Might not matter. Greenwood kept it alive. Mitch White, Hutchins. High on Minson. Wanted the free kick and stopped. Minson will keep it alive. Trying to find a kill. Won't do so. Mitchie's kick quick. And once again, Jordan Russell is in the 1A seat every time, and his kick is a peach for Stevens.
He's brought it straight back into the corridor. Stevens has lifted his work rate in this third quarter.
Stevens will wheel and go. Not the best decision. Kick smothered. Lynch might get another opportunity. Ferreira claims him. Casey need the ball back in their hands. They won't get it here. Adcock. Barry just taps it forward. Stevens. The audacity to go around the body. Dalgleish in a mountain of space. Ball will sit for him. Former bomber, short down the line to the lead of Rourke Smith.
Uncontested possessions for the term, 36-17 Footscray.
And the mark numbers are a golf as well, 23-8. They've flipped the script here, the Dogs.
They're sensing a moment here, Footscray, that they can put them away.
Casey picked them apart in the second quarter. Right now, the Dogs are giving them a big, big taste of their own medicine. And this man, Tom Campbell, has been enormous so far in this quarter. Already got one, searching for a second. This would be the fifth unanswered goal in this quarter to the Dogs.
Well, they've come out with real intent, and this is their 13th inside 50 to 4 to Casey. They've really hit the scoreboard, and Lin Jong and Tom Campbell, Kobe Stevens, have really been the driving forces behind that.
One of six Dogs looking to become two-time premiership players. Won't happen on this occasion, and two normally safe and steady set shots of goal. Campbell and Jamison fluffing their lines and not capitalising on what is a wave of momentum right now for the Bulldogs.
21 points looks very different to 33. And it sits at 21 with those missed opportunities. So Casey's still alive in the contest as we head towards time on in the third term. They just need to stabilise it. At the moment it's out of control. Barry across his body inside 50, another opportunity. Good late fist there from Mitchie. Keelty under enormous pressure. Grimes back to Keelty. He's gang tackled and taken down. Umpire says holding the ball.
Well, Casey with eight players this quarter yet to touch the ball. We're nearly 20 minutes in. They just cannot get their hands on the football at the moment. And one of those players, Alex Neil Bullen, who's been a key force for him through the midfield.
Possession 63-38 this term. Honeychurch wants to improve the angle, and here's Lin Jong again.
Oh, he can't get the journey. This is probably just beyond him. The last two shots on goal from Campbell and Jamison have been out of bounds on the full.
Wants to get that extra couple of metres. Awkward looking kick to the top of the square, and guess who? Tom Campbell taking this game by the throat in the third term.
He's another player that may be getting an AFL call-up next week, depending on how Roughhead gets through the week with his eye.
Campbell from point-blank range. and the Scrays lead by 27 points.
What a footy club.
Well, the Scorpions are stunned. What a turnaround in this grand final.
They just don't know how to lie down, this Footscray side. They've just ridden the wave of momentum that the Western Bulldogs have had, and they've turned this 70-point deficit only a fortnight ago to Casey right around tonight.
5-3 to nothing from 14 inside 50s to 4. Make it 15, and Campbell, the ball is tracking him around Etihad Stadium at the moment.
Look at them.
And it's Hannon just with the instinctive lead, and there's space everywhere at the moment.
Oh, Justin Platt. He's keeping his emotions in check, but he would be absolutely furious because Tom Campbell leads up, gets hit on the chest. He can peel back, look inside, into the corridor. They weren't allowed that time and space in the first half, and all of a sudden, they're all getting involved.
It's best on ground in the A-grade amateur grand final last year. He might get another premiership medal 12 months on in different colours.
Plenty of recruiters have been following this man's journey. He's got genuine X-factor, and it was his three goals in the last quarter of the semi-final against Essendon that helped lift him off the mat and get him through to a prelim, and he's contributing again today in the grand final.
Six unanswered goals in the third term, and the Dogs lead it by 33 points. The time is now for Casey. His game slipping away at a frightening rate. Toshevsky Beckwith in on the bottom of that pack. A little bit of a scuffle again there with Munro.
72 possessions to 38. Casey just simply cannot get their hands on the ball.
Footscray's efficiency this quarter has been the difference. They're getting it and they're using it. Neil Bullen wrapped up. Once again, they win the disputed football. And once again, it's Lin Jong. Bouncing ball inside 50 to 2-on-2. Hutchins attacks it, does well. Gets it to his own advantage. Met solidly by Nash coming the other way. Hannon at ground level tries to get it to Greenwood. He's ripped off his kick. Stevens has been outstanding in the third term. Gets it to Dale. He delivers to Toshevsky Beckwith, who marks. Gets high contact from Turlick as well. And the youngster has it 60 metres from goal.
Liam Nash just put Jack Hutchins right in his line of sight there out on the far side. Just missed him.
Spears it in low again. Inside 50 off the hands of the contest. At the back, Hamilton to Jamison. And it is raining goals at Etihad Stadium.
What had been one of their biggest weaknesses all year, turning inside 50s into scores. All of a sudden in this third quarter, 17 inside 50s for 7 goals, 3. Their efficiency is through the roof.
Disposals 80 to 38, yet they also lead the tackles 21 to 11. They've had more than double the football and more than double the tackles.
Casey shell-shocked.
7-3 to nothing, and there might be more to come. Dal Gleish off to Dale, who hasn't had to do all the scoring, but he might set one up for Campbell. Dunn back onto the ground. Denies him on this occasion. Jones, White, Oliver, just forced a quick kick, and there's a wall at the moment in the Bulldog jumper, and Bailey Dale this time, the man camped there. He will and go. He's got Campbell deep, why not? John comes to fly in and add himself to the mix at cock, perhaps high. Kept alive by Hamilton, dribbles the kick forward. Another one maybe coming up. Toshevsky Beckwith put a point in the right direction. He's already got one in this quarter.
Well, they had a 10-goal last quarter against Collingwood last week, and this is equally as impressive.
Turlick the target for the kick in. Williams got across and made sure it got to the line. You just never see that. You never see double the possessions and the same team having double the tackles,
especially against Casey, that have been the benchmark side in the competition all year. They're number one in defence. They only concede 63 points per game. They've just been opened up like they haven't been all year.
It's been a scintillating quarter of football from the Dogs. Can Casey do anything at all to try and at least hang on here and try and find a goal or two before three-quarter time and just give them something to work with in the last term?
As you'd expect, it's all their forwards that haven't touched the ball, purely because the ball just hasn't been down there.
Greenwood to Adcock. Quick kick will go out of bounds on the full, and a chance for Casey to finally get a little bit of composed possession in this third term.
Ben Newton, 2 possessions. Trengrove, 2 possessions. Viv Michie, 2.
They've had just 8 marks, make that 9 now in 26 minutes. They haven't had a chance to just hang on to the football and settle things down.
And they needed to try and get composed possession about 10 minutes ago before the damn walls.
Grimes long to the wing. Wiedemann in from the side. Williams has been fantastic in the third term. Staley, quick hands. Nash through traffic. Handball missed Honeychurch. He's got a teammate down the line, but Grimes ushers him over. Stevens, 11 possessions in the third term for the Dogs. Jong's had 8. Greenwood, 6. Oliver's had 8. For Casey and Jones, 7. But beyond that, no one's had more than 4 touches for the term. It's been an avalanche. Hamilton hunting it again. Campbell puts his head down over the football, goes shoulder to shoulder with Jones, and we'll have another stoppage.
They're just a hungry, confident football side at the moment at AFL level and VFL level. This Footscray Western Bulldogs alignment.
Webb. His right boot again, pumps it into a dangerous area. Jong flies over the top. Jamison at ground level's been dangerous. Brings it back to the corridor. Nash versus Oliver. Nash goes a defensive fist. Spills to Hamilton. Quick hands to Webb. Couldn't quite hang on. Keelty links up with Smith. Smith back to Garland. And can the Scorpions get something going to the City side? Trengo versus Smith. Well done by the Bulldog defender.
An outstanding walk, Smith. What a story he would be. 307 days off an ACL mid-season turn, played a couple of AFL games, but his defensive work, there's so much more to the Rourke Smith game than simple possession. Averages only 13 touches a game at VFL level, but his defensive work is something to behold.
He's very good in the air, either taking a mark or defensively there that we saw the spoil.
Trengove and Wiedemann flew in the air, but the Dogs just mop up at ground level again. Russell back to Smith, tried to carve the kick in the Dale direction. And a rare mistake in what's been a rolled gold third quarter for the Bulldogs. Casey, 40 points to make up if they're going to turn a minor premiership into a major one. And Dundone, boos at the crowd after testing out Lin Jong, who's on the scene and might wrap him up and give him some what for. Kick to Munro, no favours. Hayes bears down on him. Garland trapped against the boundary line and simply nowhere to go. Forced a banana in hope in the end, and it's all Dogs as this ball tracks its way to Williams. He's had a lot of fun in this quarter, it has to be said. Dalgleish inboard, Adcock. Releases Barry. And control once again back in Bulldog hands. Staley, caught at the back, waits for the options to unfold in front of him. Goes in the Dale direction. Oliver held him, just panicked. And that almost sums up the third quarter in an instant.
Dale brings it inboard to Hamilton. Marks adjacent to the centre circle. And again, they've got the outside man. This time it's Dalgleish. He looks up. He's got a couple of short options. One of them's Honeychurch.
They're just running them ragged at the moment, Jace. All these little hit-up targets just working much, much harder than the Casey midfield.
Honeychurch by hand to Hamilton. Misses the target on this occasion. Neil Bullen. Backward to Garland, and he goes across the body to Newton. Newton to Kennedy, trying to get some forward movement. Kennedy to a one-on-one. Ferreira versus Barry. Ferreira used the body, the umpire said illegally.
It's just very stagnant, predictable ball movement at the moment. There's a lot of Casey players just camped in their defensive 50, and when that ball got turned over, they stood there. No one streamed off the half-back line, which they've been so good at this year.
Russell. Dalgleish lights up the Jets, gets out of trouble and delivers straight up the middle. They're wide open again. Hannon to Jamison, and he hammers through another. It's party time for the Dogs.
Well, this is the best quarter of football that they've produced this year. The 10-goal burst in the last quarter last week, that game was done and dusted. That was just a little bit of icing on the cake, but they came out after halftime down, and we were looking for a spark. Who was going to spark this Footscray side up? Well, what a great team performance it's been across the board. The defenders have done the job. The midfield have won the contested ball. And their ball use going inside 50 has just been sublime. 8 goals, 4.
Inside 50s for the quarter, 22-4. Extraordinary.
Jamison 2, Long 2, Campbell 2. Done a lot of damage. The Dogs, they will not want September to end, but it has to. Because October starts with an AFL Grand Final for your AFL team. Jones inside 50, Williams another touch. Dropped what he should have taken. Wiedemann misses the handball. Hayes in there. He's clean. Wants Barry and finds him. Everything working right now for the tricolours. Stevens kick. Finds Webb. He's got Adcock out. He'll bring it into the corridor. where once again they can just operate in whatever space they want. Jones, though, claimed, wants to find Staley. Desperate work from Newton. And you think Casey need one before the siren here if they're going to be any sort of chance. 46 points the margin. Bulldogs in their second year under Ash Hansen. 12-6 in the home and away season in both years. A double chance last year out in straight sets. And right now, a big whiff of a second premiership in 3 years in the VFL. An unbelievable third term, it has to be said, from the Dogs. 8 unanswered goals and a 46-point advantage at the final break.
8-4 In those great Carlton sides of the late 70s and early 80s, they called the third quarter the premiership quarter when the Blues put the foot down. Well, that's exactly what Footscray have done this afternoon. A stunning third quarter of football from Footscray. And as we turn for home in the VFL Grand Final, it's the Doggies by 46 points.
The three-quarter time break brought to you by Harvey Norman.
Quarter time in the VFL Grand Final, and here's the story of the day so far. That's what it's all about. And for the first half of football, it was as tight and tense and tough as we thought it would be. 2 goals apiece in the opening quarter. Saw Footscray lead by 6 points. They're inaccurate. They kicked 2-7 to 2-1. Dominated the inside 50s, but didn't really put it on the scoreboard. And this, on the quarter time break. Second term, Casey kicked 4 goals to 2 and started to take control of the game late in that quarter. Their bigs started to take control. Hewlett, Wiedemann and Smith kicking 5 between them. They led by 6 points at half-time. The third term, simply extraordinary. The Dogs kicked 8 goals 4 to Casey, no score. An absolute avalanche from the Bulldogs. Some of the finest football we've seen in the VFL for many, many years. And at three-quarter time, they lead by 46 points. Footscray 12-13-85, leading Casey 6-3-39 with a quarter to play in the grand final.
Casey just lacked a thirst for the appetite after half-time. They got dominated inside 50s and disposals, but the key stat was they still lost the tackle count 25-17, which just tells me they went in at half-time, switched off, and they just didn't anticipate and expect what was to come after half-time. It's Ling Zhong, they're trying to manage some of his game time, no doubt.
8 possessions in that third term. What a blitz it was. He's had 23 for the day, second only to Kobe Stevens with 24, while Clayton Oliver's been outstanding for Casey with 27 possessions. So the margin, 46 points. We're just waiting on the timekeeper here at Etihad. We're all good to go. Hit the button. The
timekeeper might have fallen asleep.
Footscray, 12-13-85. Casey, 6-3-39. Final term of the VFL Grand Final. Jason Bennett alongside Nigel Carmody, Campbell Brown, Abby Holmes and Nick Carnell. Can Casey get some sort of flyer and get some momentum back into this game? Oliver tracks it. Wins it again at ground level. Bangs it on his left boot. Goes inside 50. The number one attacking team in the competition, Casey, if they can get on a roll, they can kick goals quickly. Smith just bustles Staley out of the way. Gives it to Jones. Brings it inboard. Standing underneath, it's Webb. Nice protection from Jordan Russell as well. And Lucas Webb takes the mark. 19th possession for him coming up. It's been the silent assassin this afternoon. Just gone about his business. That not a good kick. It's picked off by Mitch White. Scorpions need everything to go right here. Can they kick some quick goals and put some pressure back on Footscray? That's Russell. He's been doing it for years in the VFL. Just drifts across the contest and takes the mark.
He's in the team of the year this year for the second year running on the halfback flank, and he just marks everything in his vicinity. Development coach at the Western Bulldogs, and what better way to develop the young guys and be out there and play alongside them? He's been simply superb.
Second in the VFL for marks this year, Jordan Russell. 19 touches, 8 marks today. Done the fist, Adcock. Maybe looking at his first premiership medal and maybe a farewell long. He's backed up his 6 goals last week with 2 today. He's corralled, and in the end, Hamilton scores a try, and the umpire will deem that to be deliberate. So umpire right on the scene, and able to adjudicate that that was taken over deliberately. So Jack Tringove
Bulldogs 90 seconds closer to perhaps emulating Geelong in 07 and Box Hill in 13 as the first part of an VFL AFL Premiership double. Frankston Bulldogs fans cannot believe the 3 weeks of their lives they've had. That loss to Fremantle in round 23 and the loss to Casey in the qualifying final are a long, long way in the rearview mirror right now. Campbell, who was enormous in that third quarter, down for Adcock. Webb, contested as always. Neil Bullen gets a kick away while on his back. Turlick had Hamilton in his sights. It's Jones trying to get away from Russell. Pops the handball for Oliver. Nailed by guess who? Liam Nash exerting his influence. Russell once again just sees it out of harm's way.
The Footscray just come in waves. They have not given Casey any time and space right throughout the course of the day. And Liam Nash, which must be absolutely wrapped. He started this week with that 1 week suspension, thinking it was all over, the dream was done, and now he's out there, had it overturned, and he's been critical.
So time the friend of the Bulldogs. They're happy for the game to go up and down on the spot and chew through the minutes. Stevens run down, strong tackle. Coming in hard there was Dalgleish. Michie coming the other way. The ball wedged underneath.
Thank you. Casey with the number one contested side in the competition going into today, and they've simply been out-hunted in the second half.
Greenwood fashions a kick towards half-forward for Honeychurch. Quick hands was beautiful to Ben Long, who glides to 48 metres, measures the kick and misses.
Hit the post. Could have thought his way through that a little bit more. He had a player on his inside. He could have drawn the player, made a real certainty of it.
2-2 to Long. Big kick in from Darnan. Jordan Staley just growing in confidence throughout the day. Plucks it off the back of the pack. Quick kick back inside 50. Off the contest. Tracking back hard. Krzyzewski Beckworth just wanted it more. Kick across the face. And Honeychurch can't quite keep it alive.
Jordan Staley's a great story. He played in the semi-final against Essendon. Only had the three disposals. Was really poor. Although he kick a good goal in that last quarter. Got dropped for the preliminary final and has been brought in here today
as cover for Fletcher Roberts
to play on some of the big Casey tall forwards. And right from the get-go, he's been really, really impressive, Staley.
Dogs with 9 of the last 10 goals. Oliver met solidly by Long. Pinballs its way eventually to Spencer. There was a throw in the contest. It's going to go the way of the Scorpions, and Matt Jones will take the free kick and another Casey player down, this time Ben Newton. Day of knocks and injuries. Casey just have to take risks, and they'll do so here. Mitchie off to Turlick. He's got plenty of space and galloping room to try and use. He'll have a second bounce, run his full term, steady and coming board for Tringove.
A bold play straight up the middle of the ground as we see Newton in the hands of the trainers. And Turlick, who didn't touch the ball at all in that third term, getting involved there. Good decision just to lower his eyes and hit up the target, not blaze away himself.
Nasty twist of the ankle there for Newton.
8-7 for the year for Jack Tringove, who have... The Scorpions have not kicked a goal since Liam Hewlett at the 26-minute mark of the second quarter. Tringove adds a much-needed seventh.
You guys to compete, start changing lanes, deception, bonnet, keep the ball in motion, all right? Hutchie defenders, if the ball's there, we go and we clear the area.
Come on,
boys.
We've
got to start around the middle of the ground, in here.
Go.
We understand that?
Yeah.
Margin back to 41 points. Spencer wins the tap, but Stevens wins the clearance. Takes the football away, gains some territory. Nice smother from White. Now an opportunity for Newton. Sizzles a kick low. Was looking for Tringove, but it got picked off by Lynch. Brad Lynch spears it to 50. Stevens has snuck into some space. Couldn't quite hang on to the mark. He's got Campbell in support. The big man trots to 30, but misses. Two goals in that third term to Tom Campbell. Played a huge role in turning this game on its head.
Yeah, he'd be disappointed with that, Tom Campbell. Very, very gettable goal there under no pressure.
Lyndon Dunn goes the spiral, doesn't quite catch it. It'll still bounce to the middle of Etihad Stadium. Barry links up with Lynch. Draws the men to him. Dalgleish, short to Barry. Pokes it down the line looking for Jamison. Garland gets across and thumps it to the line.
Love the decision-making of Brad Lynch. Just... He knows when to go quick, when to go slow.
He's got some class about him, doesn't he?
He does. He's a beautiful kick of the footy, but he's a really creative footballer.
took a little bit of time to settle into the tempo. His first three games at VFL level, he struggled to just pick up the pace of playing against men. I mentioned earlier he played Colts underage footy last year, but once he settled into the season, he's been outstanding. As Jong goes to Adcock, it's a two-on-one, and this time that's easy pickings for Lyndon Dunn. He's been a great servant of the club, Lyndon Dunn. 165 games for Melbourne. Oliver has to win the contested football. They come from all sides. Mitchie to White. Can they get something going now? Neil Bullen, handball is floated. Newton, Trengove, Mitchie, they link up through the middle. Takes on the tackler. Turlick in support. He tries to step around Russell. It was hard work, but they eventually got it to Kilty. Kilty's got a man in space in the pocket. And he chips it over the top to Wiedemann.
Well, probably a harder shot on goal than the one Kilty was just about to take. They've thrown Kilty forward. He's spent the majority of the day down back today. He can kick a goal. He kicked two last week in the first half in the prelim.
Sam Wiedemann has been a sharpshooter all year, as we mentioned. He's got 25-5 in the VFL and three straight in the AFL. Keeps it low. It's across the face.
That just sums up Casey's day a little bit. This is a man that very, very rarely misses. And he couldn't convert.
27 scoring shots to 12. Dogs kicked 8-4 in that third quarter. Garland flying from the side. Bring it to ground level for Neil Bullen. Must find a target. Wants it to be Ferreira. He'll try and shield the footy from Dalgleish. He's on the scene to the nine. Marcio Ferreira, 23rd man today for the Casey Scorpions. 23rd man in the opposite jumper, Ben Long. Been a key part of the Dogs. Now 41-point lead with a couple of goals and hand and a couple of others as well. McInerney caught at the back but got the tap. Smith, so important in that second turn, but on that occasion throwing it. Williams, huge in the third quarter for the Dogs. Goes for Hannon. Long brought his man to the contest, and two of the real fireflies combined for the Dogs. Hayes into space, forced to the line, keeps it alive, did well. Eventually finds a target. Fellow Melbourne Grammar student in Long. Hamilton tunnels it along the ground. Hayes with only half a pair of shorts. Inboard for Williams. And they've got it back on their terms at the moment. The Dogs, no goals in this quarter, but Casey with only one in 9 minutes. Williams found some space. Barry, ball was touched. It'll sit for him. He turned 30 on Friday, looking for a premiership medal. Inboard for Greenwood. Can't find Honeychurch. Webb, clean. Back to Barry. Sends it high. Not necessarily long enough either. Neil Bullen. Barry, a third touch in this sequence. Off to Stevens. Off a step. Goes deep. And catches the line on the wrong side. So Casey will get ball back in hand, but have the clock against
him. He's had a good day. Kobe Stevens worked tirelessly. 27 disposals. But just his kicking's let him down on occasion. He's kicked it into the man on the mark a few times. And missed that shot on goal then.
Anthony Barry in unfamiliar territory in his 30th VFL game. Was looking for his first goal. Had a couple of goes at it. Not to be. Smith to Ferreira. Draws the man. Gives the handball to Kennedy. Forced to kick high. Adcock goes back with a flight. Stands underneath it as Wiedemann comes thundering in the other direction. Williams. Handball. From Jong to Webb. Dangerous kick to the middle. Trengove got across. Forced the turnover. Smith to Mitchie. Slips away from Stevens, runs to 65, goes towards Tim Smith in best position, and he marks 20 metres out directly in front.
Well, Casey just playing with a little bit of a freedom now to take some risks, come through the corridor, which they haven't seen them do so far today. It's worked for them. Much more clean inside 50 entries.
Sam Wiedemann retrieves his boot on the way to the boundary line. Tim Smith a chance to kick goal number three. In that first half, when they were getting the supply, their tall forwards looked dangerous, but they've been starved since half-time. And Tim Smith kicks his third.
Gives them half a chance.
Pensive collection of Western Bulldogs. Luke Beveridge at top of shot in a denim jacket. So the equation for the Casey Scorpions is six more goals without a Bulldog score, and maybe somewhere between 15 and 20 minutes of footy left. Spencer will clear it. They've got a marking target. It'll get through hands. Barry at the back, paddles it forward. Ferreira. Casey have the numbers. Ferreira lost it around his back. Barry did really well. Thrown to the ground by Kielty. Dale on hands and knees collapses.
K Casey, just starting to win some of the clearances, which they couldn't do in that third quarter. That's where the game got away from them. But so far in this last term, just being able to get the ball their way. Here they go again from the clearance.
Neil Bullen didn't hit the kick right, and there's too much on it for Hewlett, and Staley will be a happy recipient. Former St Kilda rookie. Kick a little bit shallow. Give Spencer a chance. It lands in his arms virtually. Grimes, Hutchins, Neil Bullen. Forced into the corridor. It's risky. Can Smith make good of it? He was high in the contest. There was a chop. Advantage paid. Smith too much on the kick. And again, Anthony Barry. Stayed out of the Frankston YCW Premiership team last week to try and play in a VFL one here today. His kick chopped off though. By White. We'll try and transverse the square. It's risky. Chance for Honeychurch. Presence of mind just to tow it forward. And then career after it again. He's got Munro in his sights. Munro will gather the handball for Neil Bullen, who is just going a little bit too quick to try and turn and stay in. And Casey just need to make every post a winner here. The Bulldogs with a 35-point advantage as they look for their second VFL Premiership in 3 years.
And Jong on screen certainly played himself in AFL Grand Final contention. He couldn't have done much more this afternoon. Vincent, Dale, now Spencer trying to gather. Nash puts his head over the football. Oliver waiting for it to come out. It doesn't. So Casey leading the inside 50 count in the last term, but unable to make real inroads on the scoreboard. They've kicked 2-1. The Dogs 2 behinds. Nash, third man up. And as far as Grimes, who's immediately harassed by Lin Jong. Lin Jong up to 26 possessions, 6 inside 50s.
4 tackles, but more importantly than that, he's had about 5 goal assists, Jace. Every time he's had the ball in his hands, something good has come of it. He's been scintillating today.
He got tested early by the Casey side on a number of occasions. He got through that test. Has been a massive contributor this afternoon. Campbell Brown involved in the voting for the Norm Goss medal. The best man on the ground as Webb tries to spin out of the Oliver tackle and the ball spills Fran out.
Casey just need to continue to throw caution to the wind here. Get the ball out into space. They love it in close. That's been their goal all year, but maybe Spencer here just needs to slap it over the back or be a little bit bold because they need to score here.
Webb taken down by Kennedy. The crowd in at Eddie had this afternoon, 17,348. Hundreds of thousands more watching on at home. It's Adcock's kick inside 50. Big fly in from the side. Joel Smith with the athletic leap. Spencer and Minson again. Long tries to just carve through the traffic. Gets it off to Webb, who was just pushed as he kicked it. So there's Lin Jong going to ground with Oliver.
He's been on the bottom of plenty of packs.
Sure has. That's the only concern now, isn't it? 16 minutes gone in the last quarter. They tempted to take him off and protect him.
Just clutching at that shoulder.
It's done. Goes to Smith. Play on the call. Good hunting from Honeychurch. Rounded up Kennedy. Kick goes into the middle of the ground. It's a 2-on-2. And Russell steps through the traffic. Delivers it back inside 50 and finds Honeychurch. 40 metres from goal. Marginal angle. Mitch Honeychurch, chance to go back. Kick his first for the afternoon. He's kicked 8-16 for the season. It's been the only blot on his copybook. Averaging 27 possessions, 5 clearances and 6 tackles a game. He's had 16 today.
Jordan Russell's work across the half-back line been brilliant.
Gives it off to Lynch, who's got a little bit more penetration in his kick, but good pressure from Smith. High to the square and Hannon the big fly. Off hands to Dale. Hannon at ground level. Misses. Well, we saw Mitch Hannon pre-game in our Plays of the Year. He took Mark of the Year and tried to top his own effort there.
That would have been a real contender. He can fly. He's got a little bit of Jeremy Howe about him, doesn't he?
We took 2 absolute screamers this year. We only fitted 1 into the top 10 as Dunn's Torpedo punt tumbles onto the chest of Alessio Ferreira.
So four behinds in the final quarter so far for the Dogs after they kicked 8-4 in that third quarter. Scott, hand off to Jones. Runner outside is Tringove. Has to gather and is mown down by Russell. What a game the captain's playing. Turns it over for Nash. Minson, four to the footy. Looking at a premiership medal, potentially Big Will.
Oh, Big Will, but moving like Chautauqua there on the wing.
Man in board for Geelong. A little bit more Prince of Penzance than Chautauqua about it. More your grinding stave and speed. Nash, another touch. Ball was touched. Williams, just the clever body use, and then spins through traffic. Tumbles the kick forward. 2-on-1 for the Dogs. And Jamison's body work. No hands in that one. And here's a chance for a third second-half goal.
He kicked two in that third quarter. 20 goals for the year for Nick Jamison. Scotch old boy.
So he's been part of their VFL setup for all 3 years, but he missed out on the party in 2014. Just squeezed out of that premiership team. Certainly taken his opportunities on the big stage. Normally a very good set shot for goal. Two already. Leads all scorers on the ground with three and might have handed the Dogs the cup.
Justin Platt with that sinking, helpless feeling.
Yeah, they wouldn't have anticipated a result like this today. And that third goal to Nick Jamison puts him on top of the goal kicking for Footscray. He's just leapfrogged Hennon and Dale, who both have kicked one so far today.
Campbell got the tap. Taken away by Newton. Towards half forward. Lunge from Hewlett. Tapped it to his own advantage. And now has a teammate in support, Turlick. Steps inside, tries to get past Lynch, can't do so, gone.
They're just relentless. As a player, you know when the game is done and dusted, and Footscray would know now that they have this premiership in the bag, but they are not resting on their laurels. They are still working and tackling as hard now as they were at the first minute mark of the game. It's a testament to them.
Almost going to hit the ton again in the tackle count, 97 to 75. And we asked pre-game, is it going to be that sort of manic tackling performance from the Dogs? When they beat Casey in round 15, they had 131 tackles, which is just astonishing. And it really has been that four-quarter pressure again from Footscray. It's the blueprint, and it's worked for them once again. This time much more emphatically because they've got conversion to go with their pressure as Jones goes to Tim Smith, who's a chance to go back and kick his fourth.
He's been their best forward this afternoon, as he is most weeks. He just is a workhorse, and he's 25 years of age. I wouldn't say he's missed the boat in terms of an AFL chance, because he could slot straight into plenty of AFL sides and have a real impact.
Smith from a tight angle for goal number four. Not quite. 3-2 to Tim Smith, the margin at 42 points. Into time on final term in the BFL Grand Final. Jordan Russell, the skipper. Thumps it long. Minson, McInerney, spills to the front. Dogs again front and centre. Campbell received an awkward handball from Jamison. Kilty, quick hands to Hutchins. He gets the hands free. Back to Kilty, who throws a boot at it. Inside 50, and Jordan Russell picks it off once again.
Ninth mark for Jordan Russell. You'd imagine he's in some sort of contention for a Norm Goss medal.
He's been brilliant, hasn't he? Casey have put no time and effort into him at all today, and he's cut them up.
Smith, Russell, bounces off the Turley tackle, chopped off. Chance for Scott, a rare highlight for Angus Scott on a tough day.
Really nice finish. And Scott with a nice finish there. He's had a quiet last fortnight, only the 8 disposals last week, and just 5 so far today.
After he kicked 4 goals against the Dogs in the qualifying final. Oliver can't get free from that Nash and Minson tackle.
Thank you.
Not the sandwich you want to be in.
1 metre.
Minson tries to get it to John. He's got Newton taking him to ground and just works that shoulder once again. He's passed the test so far, Lin Jong. He's getting tested all the way to the final siren, though. Minson out of the ruck towards Campbell, coming in the other direction. Smith gets there first and gives it off to Hutchins. Now back to Smith. High kick towards the middle of the ground. Minson and Spencer lock up, and here's Jong again. 28th possession for Lin Jong, second only to Clayton Oliver. Goes to the city wing and finds Kobe Stevens, who's been outstanding as well. This is his 28th. He'll launch it long. Campbell's a target with a couple to beat. McInerney the spoil. Hutchins the crumb. Handball misses Garland and he runs it out. Umpire says, throw it in.
Another big crowd have attended today, 17,348. A lot of Footscray fans as well.
Minson and McInerney again. Minson lays it down at the feet of Stevens. Hayes, Hamilton. Adcock had to be quick. Good pressure from Turlick. Forced the turnover. And now Oliver a chance. On the break. Smith, as you can see, heading goalward now as Wiedemann gets it and goes. Smith's got a couple of metres on Staley. That was a beautiful kick from Wiedemann. Right on the money. Smith can turn around. Spencer has got the size advantage on Greenwood. Keelty the crumb. Newton steadies on his left and finishes with a goal.
So Ben Newton's 16th possession makes it 4-1 in favour of the Scorpions in this final quarter, but the damage done by Will Minson and his band of merry men in that third quarter when they kicked 8 unanswered goals to snatch away the premiership from the minor premier. It'll be a free kick to the Dogs, and Lin Jong, what a grand final record he's got in the Peter Jackson VFL. 31 against Box Hill in the 2014 triumph, and now up to 29 touches. Inside 50, Minson makes a meal of it. Dunn, his typical MO, just to kick it out of harm's way. Williams came to meet it. McInerney wants to find Smith. Just needs the ball to bounce up for him. That quad really starting to put pay to any pace in the Tim Smith game. Neil Bullen back in board. Stevens. They won't be denied, these Dogs. Turns back over, though. McInerney. Feigned a handball. Elects to kick. Russell. Barry. Smith. And Smith will deny Barry over the line.
They just love a contest to a man, the Footscray players. Every single one of them.
And the story is told in the inside 50 count. We said if they had sufficient supply, they could win the game. 62 inside 50s to 35. It's been an avalanche in the Dogs' direction.
Well, there's no better feeling as a player late in the last quarter of a grand final when you know the game is won. You can just really enjoy this last 4 or 5 minutes.
Bailey Dale finishing off what's been a brilliant season. Smithson, Shawshank redemption, his way out of that. Releases to Shevsky Beckwith. He started round 15 in similar fashion. Has a couple of bounces. Runs to the 50. Has a vacant goal to shoot at. And just can't get the same result. His place today, Andrew Toshevsky Beckwith, has been a real feature of this Dogs game, though.
He got found out a little bit early trying to take the game on, but as we said, just keep doing it and things will go your way, and he certainly has done that.
Lin Jong lands hard. Bulldogs fans hold their breath. Here's Oliver. You've got to get the boy off.
He just needs to put the cue in the rack, but it's just not in him.
Kennedy, inside 50. Wiedemann had the sit, and he'll get the free kick for the front-on contact.
Just such competitors.
So Lin Jong is now tracking to the bench, holding that arm. Let's have another look, and he lands right on it.
Jeez, he lands hard. So this is going to be very, very sore.
Potential story here at the 27-minute mark of the last quarter. As Lin Jong just trots to the bench, holding that right arm gingerly. The warm applause of the Bulldog faithful. Wiedemann misses.
Must have a pretty high pain threshold, Lin Jong, because
the medical staff aren't getting... Well, they are getting around him now just to ask the question. And he's said, no, I'm fine. Just a bit sore. Nash in from the side. Mitchie. Delivery inside 52 options. And Keelty takes it on his chest. These are the kicks we'd like to see Declan Keelty go back and make. He's given them off on a couple of occasions. Let's see what he's got from long range. AFL draft prospect. And again he gives it off to Dunn from 55. Won't quite go the journey. A ground level Russell to tidy up, as he's done all afternoon. Toshevsky Beckwith through his hands. Hannon at the back. Will it open up for him? Draws the man towards him. Handball not to the advantage of Webb. Keelty did well. Hannon goes back, wins the football again. Toshevsky Beckwith to Honeychurch. Honeychurch to Hamilton. Now Adcock. Exciting build-up from the Dogs. But Garland there to shut it down.
Garland take off, but it's all in vain right now for the Scorpions. Jones shares it with Kennedy. And 16 Melbourne players in the lineup. Russell again.
has not lost a contest all day. Well done from Barry. Off to Staley. And the VFL Dogs combined. Dale, such an important part of the VFL setup this year for the Dogs. He's kept their season alive virtually. Can he finish it with a goal? Goes in the Hannon direction. Had the drop on Smith. Good work from the D's rookie to halve the contest.
Nibbich Hannon just needed to come in, find the body there of Smith and protect the drop of the ball. It would have been an easy mark.
Such great vertical, Smith. Just goes straight up. Dunn goes to Mitchie. To the corridor. Trengo did well. Beat Lynch in the one-on-one. Hits the ground. Delivers again to Kielty at centre-half forward. 55 from home. Back to Trengove. Wants to get onto his right. Boot around Staley. Winds up from 48 metres. Can't get the angle right.
Declan Kielty thrown forward in this last quarter. He's been really good. Presented up. Taken plenty of marks.
Exciting young prospect. Wouldn't be at all surprised to see his name called out on AFL draft night. As Russell goes long. Grimes against Nash in the air. The ground level is taken by Trengove. Grimes, Neil Bullen, such a dominant midfield, all these names, and one of the great stories of the grand final, the 30-year-old Anthony Barry, turned 30 on Friday, won a heap of premierships at Frankston YCW, five down to the peninsula, and as the old song says, you can't beat the boys of the Bulldog breed, and today that was indeed the case. Footscray, 31-point winners, and the champions of Victoria.
And they bring so much effort every single time they come to play. What a fantastic win.
Let's head down to ground level. Here's Ab.
Lynn, last time we saw you was the AFL elimination final. You were absolutely devastated after breaking your collarbone, and just a few short weeks later, you're a premiership player with Footscray. You must be absolutely elated.
Yeah, looking back, I was probably carrying on a bit, but yeah, to win another premiership medal with these boys is, you know, words can't describe it.
And what every Western Bulldogs fan out there wants to know, how are you feeling? You copped a few heavy knocks in that game.
Yeah, the boys tested it a bit, but felt really good, so, you know, happy to get through.
Yeah. And the senior side, obviously a big win last night. They're through to their first grand final in 55 years. How much inspiration was drawn from that result and what they've achieved this year as well?
Yeah, plenty. The boys had a, you know, really great win yesterday. We mentioned it a bit, but, you know, we stuck to what the Footscray boys do and how we play, and, you know, that managed to get us over the line. So, you know, both Footscray and the Western Bulldogs are both stoked at the moment.
Well, you're such a force this year. I'll let you go and enjoy it with the boys. I know you want a good job. Well done. Congratulations.
Outstanding performance from Lynn Jong. So tough. Took everything they threw at them, and there's Ash Hansen.
Outstanding coaching performance by him as well. Always kept the belief, even at three-quarter time in the semi-final when they were down by 5 goals and looked absolutely shot. He just kept the belief. He's got a remarkable football club that he coaches, and the boys just buy in to everything that he says, as we see all the Footscray boys making, the Western Bulldogs boys making their way out onto the ground there to celebrate with some of their teammates.
Let's head back down boundary side. Here's Nick.
George, your development coach with the Western Bulldogs. Must be pretty special winning these young guys.
Oh, it's unbelievable. You work with them every day. You play with them every week. And just to see their growth and development, I'm just so happy for the boys to get a premiership medallion after all the hard work and effort we've put in this year. It was bloody awesome.
You've obviously still got AFL commitments throughout the week. Do you hold celebrations off for another week?
I might have a quick chat to Bevo in the rooms afterwards and see if he can give me tomorrow off.
Yeah, it's talk us through obviously that last quarter. Probably know you had in the bag of three quarter time through your performance of the third quarter. What was the feeling out on the ground?
Oh, we were energetic and really bubbly in the three quarter time break, and they had nothing to lose in that last quarter. We knew they were going to come at us with everything they had, and we held off. We gave them a few cheeky goals, but it was a great win.
Go and enjoy the boys, mate. Well done.
Cheers. Jordan Russell, a two-time VFL Premiership captain. He played 125 AFL games. He's now also played 121 VFL games. Almost 250 games at the AFL-VFL level. It's been a wonderful career.
It says a lot about the bloke that when he got delisted and his AFL dream finished, that he wanted to continue to play. He's obviously a development coach at the Western Bulldogs, but he just loves going out there and playing with these young guys. He's one of only two Footscray players to have played every game this year. The other was Brad Lynch. And he's still a very, very classy footballer.
And such a critical part, as of all these leaders at the Footscray / Western Bulldogs. You look at Jed Adcock, another, Will Minson, Tom Campbell, Lin Jong. There's been such an overlap of players going up and down between the two levels. You can see there the genuine bond, the genuine emotion between their VFL and AFL players.
Jason Johannesson rolling with a Bandeezy setup. He wasn't wearing that when we had a chat to him at halftime. Bandana.
Lucas Webb. Mark Austin, who did his ACL earlier in the final series, the co-captain. It's been a wonderful weekend for the Western Bulldogs / Footscray. If you're a Bulldogs fan, it doesn't get much better than this. There's Luke Beveridge. He must be very, very proud, and it sets the scene for the AFL Grand Final next Saturday. Can the Dogs bring home two Premiership Cups in 6 days? We'll find out. And no better possible way to start Grand Final week than with this sort of positive momentum. They were absolutely brilliant after halftime. The Bulldogs, VFL Premiers for 2016. 31-point winners, 13-19-97, the Casey 10-6-66. We'll be back with the post-game celebrations right after this. Congratulations to Footscray. They win their 11th VFA / VFL Premiership and their second in 3 years with a 31-point victory over Casey. Let's head down to the post-game celebrations and our Master of Ceremonies. Here's Nigel Carmody.
Ladies and gentlemen, the culmination of another fantastic Peter Jackson VFL Legendary Final Series. And maybe, just maybe, the start of a dream week for Bulldog supporters. As we begin official proceedings, I'd like to welcome forward Casey Scorpions coach Justin Platt to say a few words on behalf of his team.
First off, well done, guys. Far too good when it counted, and an exciting brand of football, and all the best for your team next week. To our boys, commiserations. It's a hard pill to swallow, but we need to learn from it. We've got to get better, and that's what the reality is. To our major sponsors, to Mercedes-Benz Berwick and the Casey of City of Casey, thanks for your support, and to the rest of our support staff, and thank you efforts throughout the year. Really value it, and thanks to all our supporters. Thank you.
Thank you, Justin. A great season for the Casey Scorpions, both their senior and development league teams making grand finals, an outstanding effort. The Norm Goss Medal has been awarded since 1983 to the best man on the ground in the Peter Jackson VFL Grand Final. I'd like to welcome forward AFL Victoria Chairman Mr. Ray Horsburgh to present the Norm Goss Medal. And what a story this is. 17 days ago, he cracked his collarbone. Today, he's best on ground in a VFL Grand Final. Lin Jong is your 2016 Norm Goss medalist. Lin Jong, you are the Norm Goss medalist, my friend.
First of all, well done to Casey. You know, it was a really good contest. You guys are really good all season, and hopefully have a good pre-season and everything. So thanks, boys.
Well done to the Footscray boys. Really loved playing with you guys today. You know, really well done to everyone. It was a really team effort. And well done to the AFL boys yesterday. Thanks to all the trainers and medical staff and all the volunteers. You know, we really appreciate your time and effort you put in. We couldn't have done it without you. Thanks to the coaches and, you know, everyone involved with the club. I probably missed out, but thanks to everyone. Thanks to the fans as well. Thanks.
Thank you, Ray, and thank you, Lynn. Maybe more to come in his football season yet. Now welcome forward Nick Jackson, General Manager of Peter Jackson, the title sponsor, of course, of the VFL, to present Premiership medals to the 23 players and Ash Hanson, the coach of today's VFL Premiers Footscray. And we begin with number 15, Tom Campbell. Number 19, Lucas Webb. Number 22, Mitch Honeychurch. Number 25, Kobe Stevens. Number 26, Declan Hamilton. The most experienced Bulldog in this team, number 27, Will Minson. Number 31, Bailey Dale. Number 34, Bailey Williams. Number 36, Brad Lynch. Number 37, Rourke Smith. Number 44, in his final game at the level, Jed Adcock. Number 46, the Norm Goss medalist, Lynn Jong. Number 51, Nick Jamison. Sorry, number 51, Lachlan Dalgleish. Now we get to number 54, three goals, Nick Jamison. Number 55, Alex Greenwood. Number 56, Will Hayes. Number 57, Jordan Staley. Number 60, Andrew Toshevsky Beckwith. Number 61, Liam Nash. Number
Number 66, Mitch Hannon. Number 68, fresh off turning 30 on Friday, Anthony Barry. Number 69, the 23rd man for the Bulldogs, Ben Long. Number 65, and now a two-time VFL Premiership captain, Jordan Russell. I'll ask Jordan to remain on stage as we welcome up the Bulldogs Premiership coach, Ash Hansen.
Firstly, just want to congratulate Casey on the year you had. You're an outstanding team throughout the course of the year. Obviously, commiserations on today, but these experiences will certainly galvanise you as a group going forward, and I'm sure you're going to have success coming your way. Firstly, I just want to thank our principal supporters, Victoria University, you've been tremendous. Western Automotive Group and Program, we couldn't have done it without you, so thank you for your ongoing support. To my fellow coaches, the VFL support staff, you put in so much time, you put in so many hours. This wouldn't be achieved without you guys doing what you do, so we're eternally grateful for you. To the player group, you guys have just been fantastic. You enjoy the times together, good or bad. You should be rewarded for all the accolades you get for the year you've had. You're a special group to coach, and I hope the memories that you've created this year are with you forever. To our supporters, thank you for tuning out today. Hopefully today's just the first of two cups this week. Thank you.
Thank you, Ash. I'd now like to welcome to stage the CEO of Peter Jackson, Mr. Paul Jackson, to present the 2016 Peter Jackson Legendary VFL Premiership Cup to Ash Hansen, Jordan Russell and the Footscray Football Club.
Congratulations to Footscray, VFL champions, for the second time in 3 years. And the euphoria that comes immediately after winning a premiership. Randy, what's it like? You were there for Hawthorn in 2008.
Oh, it's the best feeling in the world. There's far more downs than there are ups in football. And so you really enjoy moments like that. It's just a great feeling. And you know that you'll never get a chance to play with that whole team ever again. There's retirements, there's delistings, there's players that'll get traded, and so it's just a really special moment with those 23 players.
There's Luke Beveridge watching on with John Schultz. What a special time this is for Bulldogs fans right around Australia last night and then today as we get set for AFL Grand Final week. Of course, you'll catch all the action right here on 7 throughout the week, starting with the Brownlow Medal tomorrow night. Bulldogs fans just delirious. And for a team that's been starved of success for such a long time, they've got to wonder at times whether days and weekends like this would ever come. Back in 1989, the club almost went out of business and they fought on.
It's taken 27 years, but what a weekend this has been. Into a grand final and then winning a grand final at VFL level. Just unbelievable.
Well, they're delirious for a couple of reasons. Plenty of them went out and partied last night. Many of them caught the bus back
haven't been home yet.
They haven't been home yet. So, but they'd be delirious by the way their team plays. And, you know, Ash Hansen and Luke Beveridge, the way they coach, they're both of these sides respectively. Maybe that's the modern blueprint. We always talked about Clarko revolutionising the game, and the way they're doing it and the success that they're creating in a short period of time with the handball club, and they're just bold and brash. It's a new way of football and it's unstoppable.
And we've seen already at the Bulldogs what an impact having a successful VFL team has in accelerating the development of your kids. You just go back 2 years to the VFL Premiership. Some of the names front and centre then were Tory Dixon, Jack Redpath, Jason Johannesson, Lin Jong. Just makes such a huge difference to have a team at both levels that are playing in a successful lineup. They're playing the same style of football, and we've already seen guys that played VFL last year, Caleb Daniel, Shane Biggs, Toby McLean, Tom Boyd, come through and now succeed at AFL level.
The best way to teach young players and develop them quick is to teach them to win and just to teach them to compete no matter what time of the game, no matter what situation they're in. And they're a relentless group, this Footscray side. And if you play like that, you know what you're going to get week to week. And that certainly makes it more consistent and a really good side.
Pointed from Ash Hansen when he said in his speech, I hope that the memories that you've gained through this campaign live with you for a lifetime. As you said, this group will now get split up and separated. Players will be delisted. They'll retire. They'll move to other clubs seeking other opportunities. They'll never have this group together again.
Well, Will Minson, we don't know what his future's looking like. Ling Jong, obviously in talks with other clubs. Kobe Stevens as well as another guy on the draft radar.
Jed Adcock's retiring
Jed
after
Adcock's
a wonderful career.
Jed retiring, and Jordan Russell, their captain, who was so good today, hasn't decided whether he'll go on next year. So there's just four or five players, just to name a couple. Special day, special memories.
Well, a wonderful season of VFL football. Thanks so much to everyone who's watched throughout the season. Once again, another year of record ratings right throughout the year. It's been our absolute honour and privilege to bring it to you. As Luke Beveridge looks ahead, enjoys the moment, but one eye on the prize next Saturday afternoon. The Dogs have got one of two cups on offer in the VFL and AFL. Can they grab the other? On behalf of Campbell Brown, Nigel Carmody, Abby Holmes, Nick Carnell, our entire production team here at the VFL. They do a wonderful job. Jai Lawson, Jacob Walker, the team at Maguire, Cos Cardone and Luke Tunnicliffe, and then our support at Seven, Saul Stein and Gary O'Keefe. I'm Jason Bennett. Thanks for watching the VFL in 2016. Congratulations to Footscray. The Scraggers are the champions of Victoria.